And welcome to NEET Crash Course. So today we will be discussing, in this particular lecture, we'll be discussing two chapters. One is Diversity in the Living World and Biological Classification. So what exactly does diversity mean? So it means that the living world is made up of a diverse group of organisms in their form, function and structure. You know about the variety of animals and plants and microorganisms living on this planet, and that constitutes the biodiversity or the living world. What are some of the characteristics of living organisms? Now, one of the most defining characteristics of living organisms is cellular organization. And then you have growth. How is growth different in living and non-living organisms? In living organisms, growth is from the inside. Plants show indeterminate growth and animals show determinate growth. Homeostasis refers to maintenance of constant internal environment. And then another defining, not exactly a defining, but one of the characteristics of living organisms is reproduction. I said it is not a defining character, because there are organisms which are sterile, which do not reproduce, but just because they don't reproduce, you don't call them non-living. So it is not a defining character, but yes, it is one of the main characters of living organisms. Okay. Then we have metabolism. Yes, metabolism is a defining character of living organism. However, a metabolic reaction is not, because you may carry out a metabolic reaction in a test tube as well, but metabolism within a cellular architecture is something which is a defining character of life. And then you have response to stimuli. Response to stimuli is again a defining characteristic of life. And then you would like to add, it would be nice to add consciousness also as a defining character of life. And especially when it comes to human beings, we are also self-conscious, isn't it? We are also self-aware. So these are some of the important characteristics of living organisms that you must remember. So what is biodiversity? The number, the enormous number and variety of organisms that are existing on this planet is referred to as biodiversity. And then when you talk about how to deal with this enormous diversity, if you wish to study this enormous diversity, then you have to streamline your studying process. And there is a process that you need to carry on, and this process that is referred to as taxonomy. Now, the principles and processes which are associated with taxonomy include, first of all, you need to identify the organism, then you need to classify the organism, and then you need to name it. Identify means you need to attribute certain features to the animal. For example, you encounter an animal and you identify it as an insect because you see that it has head, thorax and abdomen, it has legs, six legs or three pairs of legs. So you have identified it by giving it certain features. And then you need to know where to place this animal and where, in which group to place it, depending on the similarities and dissimilarities that it shares with the other organisms. And finally, you have to name it. So this naming, the process of naming, is referred to as nomenclature. And nomenclature is done in case of plants by scientific bodies like ICBN in plants and ICZN in case of animals. So this binomial nomenclature was established by father of taxonomy, Carolus Linnaeus, and he was the one who gave two names, that is the genus name and the specific name, and that's why it is referred to as the binomial nomenclature. And you can see how even the name of the author who gave or who first described this organism is also affixed to the scientific name of the organism. So what are some of the rules of binomial nomenclature? Like we saw, you give it two names. One is called the generic name and one is called the specific name. Both the names need to be Latinized. The genus name must start with a capital letter and the species name must start with a small letter. If you are handwriting it, it should be underlined, and if it is printed, it should be in italics. And like we said, the name of the author in abbreviated form must be affixed to the scientific name. So the genus name, the specific name, and the author's name in abbreviated form is referred to as the binomial epithet. Okay. Now, why should we classify organisms? We should classify organisms because there are so many organisms on this planet. To make our study more systematic, we need to classify them. On what basis do we classify them? We classify them on the basis of observable characteristics. And here I would like to introduce you to a word that is referred to as the taxon. For example, if I take an example like kingdom Animalia. Now, when I say kingdom Animalia, here the word kingdom represents a rank or a category. So, this is called a category or a rank. It is an abstract term. But the kingdom includes a group of real organisms. That group of real organisms are animals. And such a group of real organisms are referred to as taxon. Did you understand? So, I have assigned a category or rank of a kingdom to this taxon, which includes animals. For example, another example, if I were to give you, say for example, class Mammalia. Now, once again, Mammalia is a taxon because it is a group of real organisms. It includes mammals, and class is the category or rank. On what basis do I assign the category or rank, and what are the different levels, or what are the hierarchies of category and rank? You can see the hierarchy here, starting from the highest to the lowest. This is referred to as the category hierarchy or the Linnean hierarchy, isn't it? So, kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, and species. We always start with the lowest category or rank. The lowest category or rank, or the smallest category or rank, is the species, and the highest category or rank and the largest category or rank is the kingdom. So what you do here is, it is basically you're pulling it up as you go up the ladder. Now imagine that you have 10 species. Okay, now just for example, I'm giving you. Now imagine that all the 10 species share some similarities. So you decide to place all these 10 species into the same genus. Then imagine there are different genera and they share some similarity among them. Because there are different genera sharing similarity, you place those genera which share some similarity into the same family. Different families which are similar are placed into the same order. Different orders which are similar are placed into the same class, and so on and so forth. Did you understand? So basically, a category or rank is an abstract term. It only determines the position of a particular taxon in the Linnean hierarchy, and a taxon is a group of living organisms and a group of real organisms. Is that clear? So basically, like I mentioned, taxonomy deals with identification, classification, and nomenclature. So first you need to identify them, then you need to place it in a particular class based on its observable characters, and finally you need to give it a name that is called nomenclature. Sometimes in taxonomy, we are not just bothered about classifying them and naming them, but we also take into consideration evolutionary relationships. When we take into consideration evolutionary relationships as well as comparative features, then we refer to this branch or this particular process as systematics. The word is derived from systema, which means systematic arrangement. And Linnaeus published a book called Systema Naturae, isn't it? Now, he published a book called Systema Naturae, in which he had specifically dealt with the taxonomy of animals. So what exactly is a category or a rank? So please remember, there is a clear cut difference between a category or rank and a taxon. Now, for example, if I say a group, say for example, if I say class Mammalia, all of us humans along with primates and all the other organisms which share similarity, we are put under a class which is referred to as Mammalia. Now this Mammalia represents a group of real objects. So Mammalia represents taxon. If I look at Mammalia alone, it represents a group of real objects, real organisms. All of us are mammals. So Mammalia refers to a taxon. Now, to which category or rank have I included Mammalia to? I have put it in a category or rank which is referred to as the class. So this word class, or this rank or position, class, refers to a rank or a category.
Did you understand? So a class, if I simply say class, it doesn't make sense to you. You will obviously ask me a question, which class? So I cannot use category or rank as it is to make sense out of anything. It doesn't make sense as it is. It is an abstract term. But if I use the taxon alone, if I say mammals, you will understand what mammals is. So taxon makes sense independently, but a category or rank does not make sense independently. So when I say class, mammalia, whichever is a real group, a group of real objects, that becomes a taxon, and whichever doesn't make sense on its own, if I simply say class, it will not put across the right information to you. If I simply say kingdom, say for example, kingdom Animalia, I don't mention Animalia, I just say kingdom, then the next question you will ask me is which kingdom? Because if I simply say kingdom, it doesn't make sense to you. Such components which are involved in taxonomic hierarchy, which are a part of Linnaean hierarchy, which don't make sense on their own, which represent a position on the ladder of the Linnaean hierarchy, are referred to as the rank or the category. But I can use a taxon, like I said, on its own. On its own, a taxon can make sense, but I have to assign a taxon a particular category or a rank so that I can fit it in the ladder of the Linnaean hierarchy, from the simplest to the most complex form of, or from the smallest to the largest category or rank. So you can think of the simpler example like this. I have given you two examples. One, I have taken class Mammalia as an example. I told you class represents the position in the Linnaean hierarchy, that is called a rank or a category. And I've said Mammalia is a real group of organisms, and that represents a taxon. So you have understood the difference between taxon and taxonomic categories as well as rank. Taxonomic category is also referred to as a rank. Okay.
What is a species exactly? A species can be defined as a group of individual organisms which are capable of interbreeding, meaning reproducing with each other and producing a fertile offspring. For example, there are three examples given over here: Mangifera indica. Indica is the species. Solanum tuberosum potato. Tuberosum is the species. Panthera leo lion. Leo is the species. So as you know, the second name is the species epithet or the species name or the specific name, and it always starts with a small letter. So this is the taxonomic hierarchy. We start with the species, the lowest rung in the ladder, and the kingdom, which is the highest rung in the ladder. Okay. Now what if you have many species which are related to each other? Like if I have many sections, I'm going to put them in the same class. I have section A and section B. I told you, I have section A, section B. All the students who are in section A and all the students who are in section B are aspiring to become doctors. So like you all, so I am going to put them in the same class, that is neat. Similarly, I have two species now, species 1 and species 2. Now because they are related, I am going to put them in the same genus. So on what basis did I put them in the same genus? Because the species are related. For example, I can place tuberosum species of Solanum genus and Melongena species. I am going to put them in the same genus, which is referred to as the Solanum. So that's why the scientific name of potato is Solanum tuberosum and Solanum melongena. So tuberosum and melongena are included under the same genus Solanum. Similarly, species such as Leo, Tigris and Pardus, that is lion, tiger and leopard, all of them belong to the same genus, which is referred to as Panthera, because of the similarities that they share with each other. Okay, please note the errors here. It should be in small letters, okay, and it should be underlined, and here otherwise it should be italicized. Okay. Now what if I have many related genera with me? I'm going to take all the related genera and put them into the same family. So a family is a group of related genera. isn't it? For example, I have a genus called Solanum with me, then I have two additional genera called Petunia and Datura with me. I notice that Solanum, the plants belonging to genus Solanum, plants belonging to genus Petunia and Datura, they share some similarity, so I put them in a family that is referred to as family Solanaceae. So one family includes many like genera. Similarly, the family Felidae includes two like genera, that is Panthera and Felis. Did you understand? So family is a group of related genera. Now what if you have related families? You take all the related families and you put them in the same order. For example, I have family Felidae with me, the cat family and the dog family. Now because they are related, I am going to place both of them in the same family, in the same order, that is called carnivora. In the same way, in plants also, there is family Solanaceae, family Convolvulaceae, and scientists have noticed that they have some similarities in their floral structures. So they put these two families together in the order which is referred to as polymoniales. Class, I can put similar orders into the same class. For example, in the previous slide, I told you there was a plant order called polymoniales, isn't it? Now I can put this plant order along with a plant order called Sapindales, which has mango in it. Polymoniales includes Convolvulaceae and Solanaceae, and Sapindales includes the mango plant. It is the order to which the mango plant belongs. Now I see that both these orders, remember that these belong to a rank called order, because they share similarities between them, I am going to pick them both up. I am going to say that they are similar, so let me put them in the same class, and I am going to put them to a class that is referred to as the Dicotyledonae. Did you understand? So similar orders are put together to belong to the same class. Alright? So order carnivora in animals, order carnivora and order primata are put under the same class, that is mammalia, again based on their similarities. And then related classes which have similarities are put under the same phylum. In plants we don't use the word phylum, we use the word division. For example, we saw that there was order. Which order was it? Dicotyledonae, isn't it? Class. So let me take Dicotyledonae here. For example, there is an order called Dicotyledonae, and there is a class called Dicotyledonae, and there is another class called Monocotyledonae. Now I see there are some similarities in them. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to place these two classes together in the same division. The example is, I know that they are flowering plants, so I put them under Angiospermae. So if I see any similarities in two different classes, I'm going to pool those classes together and I'm going to put them in the same division. So again, it's basically what I'm doing is, as I'm climbing up the ladder, I'm pooling the entities together, and as a result it is cumulative as I climb the ladder. Okay, kingdom is the highest category or rank, and one important thing you should remember is it is the largest and the highest category. For example, kingdom Plantae includes all the plants and Animalia includes all the animals. And one important thing is, as you climb up the ladder, the common characters go on decreasing, isn't it? Now for example, you started with what? You started with section, and then you moved on to class, then standard, then college. So which is more specific? I told you more specific is section, isn't it? So obviously you would share most similarity with your person, with another student in the same section, rather than sharing the most similarity with another student in the same college. You are more closely related to your classmate sitting next to you in the same section than somebody else who is walking in the corridor in your college. So when we talk about section, the lowest rank, there is greatest similarity. When we talk about college, there is least similarity. Similarly, when we talk about species, it is highly specific. When we talk about the highest rank, which is kingdom, it is least specific. So as we go up, what happens? We go on from more specific to less specific, or we go on from less general to, so we are moving on up the ladder, we go from less general to more general, or more specific to less specific. Did you understand? Some of the taxonomic aids which will help you in the science of taxonomy are herbarium, botanical gardens, museums, zoological parks, and key. Now, museums where you have preserved animal and plant specimens, okay, and the preservative, for example, you're conserving them, you're preserving them in containers or jars in formaldehyde. You may also preserve dry specimens or stuffed specimens when it comes to animals. Herbarium, you know, you take the plant specimen, you collect the plant specimen, it is dried well, it is treated sometimes, it is treated with fungicides so that it doesn't get contaminated with fungi, and it is pressed and preserved, and on the sheet you need to give a lot of information about the date and place of collection and the local or the vernacular and the English and the botanical or the scientific names, who collected it, the date of collection, etc. Botanical gardens is an example of ex situ conservation. You can bring plants from different parts of the world and conserve them at the same place. Now, please, all of you must learn some of the examples and location of some of the major botanical gardens which you can expect in your competitive exams. Zoological park is similar to a botanical garden, but it is animals here we are concerned about. It is also an ex situ conservation because you are conserving animals not in their natural habitat, but you are simulating the natural environment. And then we have a key. A key is consisting of a paired word. Now, for example, let me take a very simple example. Say in plants you have something called arrangement of leaves called phyllotaxy. Now you have leaves which are arranged in alternate pattern like this on the stem, one per node, or you have leaves which are arranged two per node facing each other, opposite to each other like this. So you can say that this condition is called the alternate phyllotaxy, or this is referred to as opposite phyllotaxy. Okay, so alternate and opposite phyllotaxy. Now notice I have created a key because I have used two words over here. That is, one is opposing the other. Alternate phyllotaxy is different from opposite phyllotaxy, isn't it? So now this forms a pair and this becomes a couplet. Now suppose you have a plant in your hand and you want to check this particular key. Now suppose you have, say, a plant which has alternate phyllotaxy, then which one will you omit in this pair? You will omit opposite phyllotaxy because, okay, this doesn't suit me because I don't have a plant which has opposite phyllotaxy, but I have a plant which has alternate phyllotaxy. So you will select this option, and whichever option in this pair or couplet, whichever choice you make, that becomes a lead, because that will lead you on to further identification, as in alternate phyllotaxy will lead you to other characteristics of the plant which are specific to that plant, which may help you in identifying that plant. So a very simple key, just to make the concept clear to you, that is alternate or opposite. Alternate or opposite phyllotaxy. I would choose one of them, I would eliminate the other. Once I choose one of them, I would go with it, and that becomes my lead, because that will lead me to many other characteristics which will ultimately help me to identify the species of plant that I have with me in my hand. Alright? Then you have many other taxonomic aids, like for example flora. In flora we talk about habitat and what is called as distribution of plants in a particular area, like for example flora of Karnataka. Now in flora of Karnataka you have what all types of plants, where do they live, and how is their distribution on the land of Karnataka is basically spoken of. Along with flora you also have something called a manual, and you have something called a monograph. A manual has information about all the species of plants in a particular area. Okay, so if you want to know what are all the species of plants in a particular area, not just plants, it may be species of organisms in a particular area, you would opt for a resource in taxonomy that is called flora. Then what is monograph? A monograph means it has information about a single taxon. A taxon, like I said, is a real group of organisms. For example, there is information, if I have a book with me and I have information about all mammals in it. So mammals is a taxon because it is a group of real organisms. So then such a book which has information about a particular taxon is called a manual. A book which has information about all the species in an area is information about a particular taxon is a monograph. Information about all the species in an area is a manual. Information about habitat and distribution of plants in a particular area is nothing but flora. So these are some of the taxonomic aids which you must know about. So now let us move on to the next chapter, that is biological classification. Aristotle was the one who first gave a very, very simple classification entirely based on observable characteristics. He classified plants into trees, shrubs and herbs. He classified animals into inaima. The spelling is wrong over here. Inaima are those animals which, according to him, he put all the animals having red blood in inaima and all the animals which had white blood without red blood or colorless blood, then he put them in anima. This is a very vague form of classification because you are not taking into account anything but the external appearance. Linnaeus contributed to classification because Linnaeus was the one who proposed the two kingdom classification, that is kingdom plantae and kingdom animalia. But he ignored a lot of things. He did not consider cellular architecture. He did not consider the cellular organization. He did not consider the mode of nutrition, that is whether the plants were autotrophic or the organism was autotrophic or heterotrophic. Okay. Then therefore today we don't follow Aristotle's or Linnaeus's theory. Even Ernst Haeckel's three kingdom classification, where for the first time he included a group which includes unicellular eukaryotes under something called kingdom Protista. So you can see how the hierarchy is. Aristotle just classified vaguely based on external morphology or observable characters. Linnaeus gave the two kingdom classification. Ernst Haeckel gave the three kingdom classification, and he included the kingdom that is called Protista. Now you have to remember, what are the drawbacks of the Linnaean classification? What are some of the features he did not take into consideration? Okay. Copeland introduced kingdom Monera, which includes all prokaryotes in it. And what we follow is R.H. Whittaker's five kingdom classification, and he introduced it including all the important aspects, like he took into cellular architecture, the cellular organization or body organization, the mode of nutrition and how the organism survives in the ecosystem. And also he took into consideration the evolutionary relationships between organisms. And then we have another widely accepted system today, which was introduced by Carl Wiese. And Carl Wiese introduced the domain classification. He included three domains: archaea, the most primitive forms of bacteria, and eubacteria, the modern forms and or the evolved forms, and eukarya, which includes all the eukaryotes. So archaea and eubacteria together include prokaryotes, whereas eukarya includes the cells, the true cells or eukaryotes. Viruses. So Pasteur was not the one who coined the term virus. It was D.J. Ivanovsky. D.J. Ivanovsky was the one who used the word virus for the first time. And in 1892, he was working on and he recognized a particular virus, which was the causative of the mosaic disease in tobacco, which is referred to as the tobacco mosaic virus. So this modification has been done in the newer editions of the textbook. It was not Pasteur who coined the term virus. It was D.J. Ivanovsky. And M.W. Bejerink in 1898 called viruses as a contagious venomous fluid, that is Contagium vivum fluidum, because he collected extract from infected tobacco mosaic plants and he saw that it could produce the disease on healthy plants. And then in 1935 it was W.M. Stanley who showed that viruses have a particulate nature and they can be crystallized, another breakthrough in the field of virology. Okay, so you should remember some of the contributions of some of the scientists in the field of virology. Characteristics, you know that viruses are considered to be the connecting links between living and non-living, isn't it? So they are obligate parasites. They cannot live outside the host cell. They do not have a cellular organization. Outside the host, they are just like a particle. They're inert and crystalline. And viruses basically have biomolecules in them. That's why scientists are torn between calling them living or non-living, because they do have biomolecules. They do have organic substances like proteins and genetic material such as DNA and RNA. They have a DNA or RNA in their central core, which forms the core of the virus particles. And of course, most of these viruses which infect plants have single-stranded RNA. Animal viruses may either have single or double-stranded RNA or DNA, whereas we have special bacteriophages. So basically, plant viruses are called phytophages, animal viruses are called zoophages, and bacterial viruses which attack bacterial cells are called bacteriophages. They have double-stranded DNA as their genetic material. Now you can see the structure of tobacco mosaic virus, which was discovered by D.J. Ivanovsky in 1892. He found the causative of the tobacco mosaic disease. It has basically a cylindrical structure here. Okay, you can see how the structure looks like, and it has a coiled single-stranded RNA inside, which is its genetic material. This single-stranded RNA has about 6,400 nucleotides in it. And you can see a protein covering, which is referred to as the capsid, and each individual component or subunit in the protein covering is referred to as a capsomere. And there are totally how many such capsomeres? There are 2130 capsomeres which are present in this particular case. Okay, now they have the length of this particular virus particle is about 1000 angstroms, and it has a diameter of 180 angstroms. So this is the structure of, so you need to remember, they have a spiral single-stranded RNA structure which measures about 6400 nucleotides, and they have a protein coat which is made up of 2130 capsomeres, length is 1000 angstroms, diameter is 180 angstroms, and their RNA has 6400 nucleotides. Okay, now what is a bacteriophage look like? Now a bacteriophage has a polyhedral head, and then it has a collar, and then the tail has a tube, a core, which is a tube like structure, but around the tail there is a sheath, there is a proteinaceous sheath around the tail. And you can see how this core in the tail is connected to the head with the help of this collar. This tube is the core of the tail, alright? And this outer covering is referred to as the sheath. And this entire structure is the tail. Inside the polyhedral structure, you have the double-stranded DNA. At the base of the tail, there is a hexagonal or a polygonal basal plate like this. The lower surface of the basal plate has tail pins. There are 6 tail pins which help it to land on the bacteria. And then from the angles of the basal plate, you have these tail fibers which emerge. Okay, so this gives you a idea of what is the structure of the bacteriophage. So basically there is a head, there is a collar, there is a tail which is covered with a sheath, and this is referred to as the basal disc or the tail plate. And these are the pins, the tail pins or the pegs, and then these are the tail fibers. Okay, so this is how a bacteriophage looks like. And then you have viruses, which also cause a lot of deadly diseases in humans. And you also know the currently ongoing coronavirus, that is also a virus, as you are aware. In plants, they cause mosaic disease. Then mostly in plants, they have symptoms like reflowering and curling and yellowing and dwarfing. And basically, the growth is retarded, and this is called stunted growth. Okay. T.O. Diener in the year 1971 was the one who discovered a very, very unique pathogenic entity, which he called as viroids. Surprisingly, the viroids are very similar to virus, but they only have free RNA. They have a circular single-stranded RNA. But what is missing in them? They don't have a protein coat. Do you understand what I'm saying? Protein coat is missing. Only the nucleic acid is present. And the nucleic acid has about a length of 250 to 370 nucleotides. It is single-stranded circular RNA. It causes diseases such as potato spindle tuber viroid. There is a viroid called PSTV. It causes a disease called potato spindle tuber. Then there are other viroids also which cause diseases in plants, such as there is the chrysanthemum stunt. Then there is Citrus exocortis. Yes or no? So these are some of the examples. PSTV, chrysanthemum stunt, and Citrus exocortis. They basically affect plants. Now, recently, included in your textbook, another infectious particles which are referred to as prions. Now, the discoverer of prions, that is Stanley Prusner. Now, he was awarded Nobel Prize in the year 1997. Basically, prions are nothing but abnormally folded proteins. It is surprising that proteins can cause disease, isn't it? So, here we saw it was only, viroids were only RNA. Now we are saying that these are only, prions are only proteins. These are abnormally folded proteins, and Stanley Prusner discovered them, and for which he was awarded a Nobel Prize. The most famous disease, the most well reported disease which is caused by prions, is in case of cattle. It is called the mad cow disease. It is also called the bovine spongiform encephalopathy, which is BSE, and a related disease in humans. It is called CJD, which is Creutzfeldt Jacob. So please take down all these points. It will help you to go through when you're preparing for your NEET exam. So prions are also included here. They're infectious proteinaceous particles, abnormally folded infectious proteins that have the ability to cause disease. Prions cause mad cow disease or bovine spongiform encephalopathy. In humans, they cause something called Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, isn't it? And they also are known to cause another disease in tribal humans, which is called the Kuru disease, K-U-R-U. Alright, and there is one more disease they cause in sheep. It is called the scrapie disease. So these are some of the diseases. In humans, they cause CJD, Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease or Kuru disease. And in sheep, they cause scrapie. In cattle, they cause bovine spongiform encephalopathy or mad cow disease. So it is very surprising that nucleic acids alone can cause diseases such as viroids, and proteins alone, which are abnormally folded, are capable of causing diseases. Kingdom Monera includes Archaebacteria and Eubacteria, and includes the modern photosynthetic bacteria which contain chlorophyll A in them, that is cyanobacteria. Archaebacteria are the most primitive bacteria. They have special non-cellulosic polysaccharides and proteins, and they have lipid layers which help in a very thick lipid layer in their cell membrane, which helps them to overcome or withstand stresses of high temperature and other extremes of conditions. We have methanogens, which are basically the type of archaebacteria. Methanogens have the ability to convert carbon dioxide, methanol and formic acid into methane. That's why they are called methanogens. And methanogens are chemosynthetic. Later you will understand what is chemosynthetic. Now just remember that they derive energy. Where do they get energy? They get energy by oxidizing chemicals. Okay, now these are methane producers. They are anaerobic, they are obligate anaerobic, and they are mostly found in marshy areas. And you know the use of them. You can use them in biogas plants. They are used in production of biogas. And methanogens are very commonly found in the stomach of cattle, in the rumen of cattle. And their job is to convert carbon dioxide, methanol and formic acid into methane. And they are chemosynthetic in the sense that they can derive energy in the form of ATP. And how do they obtain this ATP? By oxidizing chemicals which are present at their disposal. Okay? Examples is Methanococcus and Methanobacterium. Halophiles are salt-loving organisms. These are salt-loving bacteria. These are referred to as halophiles. They need a very, very high salt concentration in order to survive. They are anaerobes. Alright. Now, these halophiles basically cannot manufacture their own food. So, they are heterotrophic. They are not autotrophic. They depend on outside food source, and whenever the sunlight becomes very, very intense, they start producing a purple colored pigment, which is referred to as bacteriorhodopsin, which is very, very related to the pigment present in our rods, in our retina. So this is when the sunlight is very, very intense. It is said that using this sunlight and using this pigment, that is bacteriorhodopsin, they are capable of generating ATP, but however they cannot use this ATP in order to fix the atmospheric carbon dioxide. That's why they cannot manufacture their own food, and hence they are referred to as heterotrophic. Did you understand? So they have chemicals to synthesize ATP in the presence of light, but they cannot use this ATP in order to fix the atmospheric carbon dioxide, or in other words, they cannot use this ATP in order to manufacture food. That's why they are not autotrophic, they are heterotrophic. Example is Halococcus and Halobacterium. Thermoacidophiles are again autotrophic, they are chemosynthetic, they can obtain energy from oxidizing substances. They are mostly found, they love very, very high temperatures and very low pH, say for example pH of 2. And what they do is they basically oxidize sulfur into sulfuric acid under aerobic conditions. That's why the sulfuric acid is what increases the acidity in their surrounding environment. And they are found in sulfur springs, they are found around volcanoes, and they are found in thermal vents. Example is Thermoproteus, and you can take down another example, that is Thermoplasma. Now moving on to Eubacteria. Now Eubacteria are the ones which are the modern or evolved or the true bacteria. You know that they have a genetic material in the form of double-stranded DNA, which is the nucleoid, and they store food in the form of glycogen. They have invaginations of the plasma membrane, that is referred to as mesosomes. Now the shapes of bacteria you can see here. If they are rod-like, they are bacilli. Spherical, they are cocci. If they are coma-shaped, as in cholera-causing bacteria, they are vibrio. And if they are spiral, it's referred to as spirillum. Mode of nutrition. There are bacteria which can synthesize food. they can make their own food. How do they make their own food? By capturing carbon from atmospheric carbon dioxide. Now, whichever organism can capture carbon from atmospheric carbon dioxide, we call such organism as autotrophic bacteria. Now, photosynthetic bacteria are those bacteria which contain photosynthetic pigments in them. Now, what are some of the pigments that they contain? They may contain a type of pigment called bacteriopurpurin, which is nothing but bacteriochlorophyll, and they may have pigments such as bacterioviridin. So bacteriopurpurin and bacterioviridin are some of the pigments which you can expect in photosynthetic bacteria. The only difference in photosynthetic bacteria is they do not liberate oxygen. So we call this type of photosynthesis as anoxygenic. Now, why do plants liberate oxygen? Plants liberate oxygen because they split. Now, these plants have the ability to split water into obtain protons, electrons, and oxygen. But these bacteria do not use water. They use sulfur. They use hydrogen sulfide. So obviously, when they use sulfur and hydrogen sulfide and they use other organic compounds, not water, but so then they are not splitting water, you cannot expect oxygen as a byproduct. So such a photosynthesis which is seen in bacteria where oxygen is not a byproduct, it is referred to as anoxygenic photosynthesis. Alright, some of the examples for photosynthetic bacteria you can include, you have the purple sulfur bacteria, you have the green sulfur bacteria, you have the purple non-sulfur bacteria, you have the green non-sulfur bacteria, okay. So these are some of the examples which you may look up to, and you have to learn some more examples under each of these categories. For example, if you take purple sulfur bacteria, the example will be thiospirillum and chromatium, and for green sulfur there is chlorobium. For purple non-sulfur we have rhodospirillum, and for green non-sulfur we have chloronema. So only a few examples I'm giving you here. Now moving on to cyanobacteria. Cyanobacteria include Nostoc and Anabaena. Okay. Now these are bacteria which are very unique because they are capable of photosynthesizing. That means they have thylakoid membranes in their cytoplasm. They are found in freshwater bodies. They're unicellular. I think you remember. They are cells which are arranged in a beaded structure like this. Correct. And they have a thick covering of mucilage on them. Now each cell in this particular colony, we call this entire thread-like structure as a trichome. Now if you look at each cell, in the cell you will have a central zone called centroplasm where there is a nucleus, and a peripheral cytoplasm or the chromoplasm where you have these membrane bound structures, these sac like structures, flattened disc like structures which are referred to as thylakoids. A very important feature is within these thylakoids you have chlorophyll A, and you have pigments which are referred to as phycobilins. Phycobilins are of three types. What are the three types of phycobilins? Red colored, blue colored, and light blue colored pigments. Okay, so peripheral chromoplasm and central centroplasm, and there are special cells in them. I'm highlighting this one cell. Such cells in the colony or the trichome are referred to as heterocysts. Now what do these cells do? These are the cells which help in nitrogen fixation. They contain an enzyme called nitrogenase. And they are very, very thick walled so that oxygen doesn't enter inside. Nitrogenase cannot function in the presence of oxygen. And these heterocysts are also sites where the trichome can break apart and therefore they may also help in fragmentation. They undergo oxygenic photosynthesis, that means they use water, they split water in order to obtain protons and electrons, and there is liberation of oxygen. Then you have bacteria which have the ability. Now we saw that there were photosynthetic bacteria. In photosynthetic bacteria, the bacteria obtain energy from the sun. They use sun energy to make ATP. But there are some bacteria which can make ATP by using energy from oxidation of certain inorganic substances, like nitrates, oxidization of ammonia, nitrites, etc. These include nitrifying bacteria. And what do we call all these bacteria which cannot obtain energy from the sun, which obtain energy or ATP in order to manufacture food by oxidizing inorganic substances? We call them as chemoautotrophic or chemosynthetic. So basically, they oxidize substances, they obtain ATP, the energy, and what do they do to this energy? They use this energy in order to make food. Did you understand? Then, there are also heterotrophic bacteria which cannot make their own food and therefore they depend on external sources. Parasitic bacteria which live on the host. Examples of heterotrophic bacteria: saprophytic bacteria which feed on dead and decaying organic matter like decomposing bacteria, symbiotic bacteria like the root nodules of plants have leguminous roots, have nitrogen fixing bacteria which are nothing but symbiotic. Bacteria reproduce by very simple fission where one cell splits into two, as you can see, and sometimes this endospore formation is not really a mode of reproduction. It is only a kind of an attempt that is made by the bacteria to overcome unfavorable conditions. Okay. During binary fission, what happens is there is a cell. Now, for example, this is the bacterial cell. It has its genetic material. The genetic material is kept attached to the cell membrane with the help of an infolding called mesosome. So what happens is the DNA also undergoes duplication. The mesosome also doubles. The mesosomes start moving away from each other and a partition is formed between the two. And this becomes one daughter cell and this becomes one daughter cell. So this is the mechanism of binary fission. And what makes the endospore overcome heat, overcome desiccation, that is complete absence of water, and they're also resistant to chemical stressors like acids and alkali? That's because this endospore that we were talking about, which is not really a mode of reproduction, but it is only meant to overcome unfavorable condition. It is called a perinating structure. In the wall of this endospore, there is a chemical called calcium dipicolinic acid. So it is called CDP, calcium dipicolinic acid, and this is what provides it with the resistance. It can resist heat, it can resist. Now, for example, if there are bacteria which have endospore in the milk, even if you pasteurize milk, even if you boil the milk or raise the temperature to 100 degrees, nothing happens to these endospores. They're heat resistant, they're resistant to dehydration, they're resistant to chemicals, toxic chemicals. That's because the wall of this endospore, like I told you, if this is the bacteria, all the contents of the bacteria, including the DNA, the genetic material, will get pulled towards one region, and there a rounded structure will be formed. And this rounded structure with a core nucleus and a core cytoplasm in it, with a very, very thick wall. The wall is basically three layered, and this is referred to as the endospore. And in the wall, there is a special substance called calcium dipicolinic acid, which offers resistance to temperature and resistance to desiccation and toxic chemicals. Okay. Importance of bacteria: saprophytic bacteria which act as scavengers. They're used in fermentation, in curdling of milk. Rhizobium acts as a nitrogen fixer. There are bacteria that cause diseases which affect our agricultural produce. They're used in retting of fibers. Now you obtain fibers from plants like phloem fibers and xylem fibers. Once you extract the fibers, if you treat them with bacteria, the bacteria eat up all the cellular components, and what is left is nothing but the cell wall component, which is very, very slow in biodegradation, which is called the fibers. They're used in production of antibiotics, and they're also used in mineral extraction. Mycoplasma are nothing but wall-less bacteria. They don't have a cell wall. They have lot of sterols in their cell membrane. They have lot of cholesterol. They have a three-layered membrane, which is called a trilamellar unit membrane. They are called PPLOs because they were identified in a disease which is called pleuropneumonia, that is found in cattle, and that's why it is called pleuropneumonia-like organisms. They do not have a cell wall. They live under anaerobic conditions. They are saprophytic and parasitic. They are not only parasitic to animals, that they are also parasitic to plants. Protista includes exclusively unicellular eukaryotic. Now we are done with prokaryotic organisms in Monera. In Protista, we have included all the single-celled or unicellular eukaryotic organisms. So in that, we have classified them into photosynthetic Protista, slime molds, and protozoan Protista. So here you can see a photosynthetic protist belonging to division Euglenophyta, that is Euglena, and these two belong to protozoa, amoeba and paramecium. Chrysophyta are those which include desmids, which are called golden algae, as well as diatoms. They are the principal producers of the ocean, and they have, for example, if you take these diatoms for that matter, they have a cell wall which resemble a soap box, a bigger valve fitted into a smaller valve. The bigger valve is called the epitheca and the smaller valve is called the hypotheca, and then there is a cytoplasm inside, there is a protoplast, there is a huge vacuole inside, and the nucleus is suspended in the vacuole by protoplasmic or cytoplasmic threads like this. So this is how a diatom looks like. And then in the cell wall, there are encrustations of silica. The cell wall is heavily impregnated with silica, and that's why it is virtually indestructible. And when this cell wall, the organism inside, the cell inside dies, the cell walls get deposited at the bottom of the ocean in the seafloor as diatomaceous earth or diatomite, which is also called the kieselguhr. This is used in night paints. It is used in night paints. It is used as a cleaning agent in polishes and toothpaste. It also has low thermal conductivity. It is used as insulator in boilers and furnaces and refrigerators. Okay, because it has a glistening or a very good reflective ability, it is also used in night paints in highways. Dinoflagellates, the most important feature of dinoflagellates is, now if this is, they have a very, very heavily armored cell wall. Now if this is a dinoflagellate, for example, they have cellulose plates in their cell wall which are tightly fitted into each other, and they have grooves, a horizontal groove which is referred to as simply as a groove, and a vertical groove which is referred to as the sulcus, and from there you have these flagella which emerge out, and flagella are at right angles to each other. Okay, some of them undergo rapid multiplication. So the groove which is circular is called a girdle, it's mentioned here, and the one that is vertical is referred to as the sulcus. Some of them reproduce very quickly to produce red tides, like for example goniolax, and some of them are also very poisonous to fishes. Okay, two types of flagella which are beating continuously at right angles, and that's why they are called whirling whips. Example is goniolax and gymnodenium. Euglenoids, like we saw Euglena, there was a confusion as to whether to call it a plant or an animal, because Euglena does not have a cell wall, correct? It has a proteinaceous covering on it, which is called pellicle. It has two flagella. They have a special type of eye spot, which has an eye pigment that is called astaxanthin. So remember that the eye spot helps them to migrate towards light areas where there is sunlight. Sometimes when there is no sunlight, they can also behave as heterotrophs. We call this as mixotrophic nutrition. They have a special reserve food material that is called paramyelin. So it's mentioned here, they have astaxanthin, which acts as the photosensitive eye spot, which is sensitive to light. They have a prominent contractile vacuole because they are freshwater bodies. They reproduce by longitudinal binary fission. Slime molds or saprophytic protists. Now, something which is very, very unique about these slime molds is that they mostly creep and crawl over dead and decaying organic matter and moist places on the forest floor. And they are basically made up of an aggregation that is referred to as a plasmodium. A plasmodium is nothing but a huge mass of protoplasm with many, many, many nuclei inside. There are no partitions between the nuclei, and therefore it appears to be a gigantic cell which multiple nuclei inside. This is what is referred to as a plasmodium. During unfavorable condition, they develop stalks with sporangia on them. Now, whenever the conditions become unfavorable, they develop sporangia on them. Okay, and now what happens from these sporangia is spores are produced, which are carried by air currents, and these spores break open, and these tiny cells come out of the spores. Either the spore germinates into these tiny cells, which are called myxamoebae, or it produces these elongated spindle-shaped cells, which have two flagella at their end. So these are called swarmers. And this is called myxamoebae. This is the spore. Did you understand? And this is the multinucleate mass of protoplasm that is referred to as plasmodium. So the plasmodium developed these sporangia during unfavorable conditions. The spore are carried. The spore either gives rise to myxamoebae or it gives rise to these swarmers. And then what happens is one or more swarmers that are produced by the spores, and you have these myxamoebae that are produced, they all fuse together in pairs. So two swarmers fuse together, or two myxamoebae fuse together, and ultimately they result in the formation of zygote. So either the swarmers fuse to form a zygote, or the myxamoebae fuse together to form a diploid zygote, and the zygote will start growing and growing and growing, and it becomes a plasmodium. So very simplified life cycle. Now what I have considered here is referred to as acellular plasmodium. Okay, what I have taken here as an example is acellular plasmodium. So remember, there is a plasmodium which have multiple nuclei in them. So these are all the nuclei. It's a mass of protoplasm with many, many nuclei in them, and they bear these erect sporangia. The sporangia give out spores during unfavorable condition. The spores germinate into either myxamoebae or swarm cells with two flagella at their ends. The swarm cells fuse in pairs, either these fuse or these fuse, but whenever they fuse, the ultimate product is zygote. The zygote germinates into another plasmodium. Okay. Protozoans include amoeboid protozoans. Now, protozoa is another division under kingdom Protista. They include amoeboid protozoans like free living amoeba, parasitic entamoeba, and free living Elphidium, which is aquatic, which have silica shell on their surface. Then you have flagellated protozoans, which have whip like flagella as their locomotory structure, and the parasitic forms such as Trypanosoma. Okay. Then ciliated protozoans, you have the slipper animalcule, which is paramecium, which have these fine hair-like cilia on the surface. So basically the classification is based on locomotory appendages. Then you have sporozoa. Sporozoans do not have any specific locomotory structures, and the most common sporozoan which causes disease in humans and which uses the female Anopheles as a vector is Plasmodium. Alright, so this gives you an overview of the classification of division protozoa under kingdom Protista. Now moving on to kingdom fungi. Fungi are heterotrophic. They cannot manufacture their own food. They don't have chlorophyll of their own, but they produce spore, and they can also reproduce sexually. They have these elongated slender filamentous structures called hyphae. The hyphae, we have multiple nuclei in them, like I am showing here. In this case, it is called a cenocytic or an aseptate hyphae. Sometimes the hypha can have partitions in them, and between the partitions you can see the nuclei. It may be uninucleate or binucleate. So this is referred to as a septate hypha. So these tube-like structures are called hypha. Many of these tubes are intertwined to form a mass of these filaments segments or a mass of hypha, which is referred to as the mycelium. Another thing is, each fungal cell has a special cell wall. The cell wall is made up of something called cellulose. Sorry, not cellulose in this case. In plants, it is cellulose. In case of fungus, the cell wall is made up of chitin. And chitin is nothing but also found in arthropod exoskeleton. And chitin is also called fungal cellulose. They are saprophytic. They feed on dead and decaying organic matter. They are mostly found in moist places. Correct? They live in moist environment. They may be parasitic or symbiotic, like in the case of lichens and mycorrhiza, where they form symbiotic association with the roots of higher plants. Reproduction in the fungi may be by fragmentation, where they split, fission in yeast and budding in yeast, that is by vegetative means, which is a type of asexual reproduction. Sexual reproduction may be involving formation of, now there are other, sorry, let me finish asexual reproduction. There are many other structures involved in asexual reproduction, like formation of flagellated zoospores, formation of non-motile spores by specialized structures. I told you that sometimes, in just like we saw in slime molds, in fungi also some of the hyphae may become erect and they may develop a structure at their ends which are called sporangia, which start producing these non-motile spores. So sometimes the spores produced are non-motile, or it may be motile and flagellated. There are different spores which are a product of sexual reproduction, which is called oospore, ascospore and basidiospores. Now, during fungal sexual reproduction, what you need to remember is, now let me say this is one hypha and this is another hypha. So let me draw partitions because it is septate. So let me show these solid nuclei here and hollow nuclei to create a distinction. Now say, for example, this hypha has a sex organ, which is called the male sex organ or the antheridium. We call it as the plus strain. And this hypha has a sex organ, which is the female sex organ or the archegonium or the oogonium, the minus strain. So what happens during sexual reproduction is, the contents of the male sex organ enter into the female sex organ. And then finally, this female sex organ will now have two nuclei in it, one that belongs to itself and one that came from the male sex organ. And of course, the cytoplasm of the male sex organ and the cytoplasm of the female sex organ have become mingled with each other. Now this coming together, or the mixing up of the cytoplasm of the male and the female, or the plus and the minus strain, is called plasmogamy. But can you see that the nucleus is still separate? Now this is the male nucleus which came from the antheridium, and this is the female nucleus that was already there. So this condition where the nucleus is still separate and there are two nuclei is referred to as the dikaryotic stage or the dikaryon. Subsequently, what will happen is, within this ascogonium or the female sex organ, both the male and the female nuclei will merge together and they will form a new nucleus. Let me shade it to create a distinction. And this is now referred to as the zygote nucleus. Now this is not the end. The zygote nucleus within the female sex organ will now undergo meiosis, zygotic meiosis. Now what happens is, the cell also enlarges in size, and now the meiosis has produced a total of 1, 2, 3, 4 nuclei. And each of these nuclei will get rounded off into spores, and the spores will get dispersed. The spores will get released, isn't it? And these spores which are released will germinate on a suitable substratum, and they will produce a new fungal hypha. So this is the summary of the sexual reproduction in fungi. So I hope you followed. There is a male sex organ called antheridium. There is a female sex organ or gametangia called ascogonium. The contents of the male sex organ migrate into the female. Their cytoplasm merges by a process called plasmogamy. But what is yet to happen? I mean, the cell now becomes, the cell now possesses two nuclei. It's called a dikaryon. Now what happens is, the nuclei fuse. I forgot to write here. The fusion of the nuclei is called karyogamy. Okay, fusion of cytoplasm is called plasmogamy. Fusion of nucleus is called karyogamy. Now you have a zygote nucleus with us. The zygote nucleus will undergo meiosis to form haploid spores. So these are referred to as the haploid sexual spores. Why are they haploid? Because the zygote nucleus underwent meiosis. They get rounded off with an envelope of cytoplasm around themselves and a wall that is generated around them. They are dispersed, and when they migrate and they fall on a suitable substratum, they will germinate into a new hypha. So this dikaryon is what you usually refer to as the temporary dikaryophase in the life cycle or in the sexual cycle of the fungus. Moving on to phycomycetes, the first class of fungus, they live on decaying wood in moist and damp places. Some of them are aquatic and obligate parasites. Their mycelium do not have septae. Like I told you, it is a tube or a filament with many, many nuclei. There is no partition or cross wall. So we call such a hypha as cenocytic. Asexual reproduction may happen through flagellated zoospores or non-motile aplanospores that are produced by sporangia. Since they are produced inside the sporangia, we can call them as endogenous. And then you can see that the zygospore, I told you, zygote is formed by the fusion of two gametes, which may be isogamous. If the gametes are alike, if the male gamete and the female gamete look exactly alike each other, then it is called isogamous. If they are slightly different, it is anisogamous. If the female gamete is large and spherical and resembling an egg, then it is referred to as the oogamous type of sexual reproduction. So examples are Mucor, Rhizopus and capital A, Albugo. So you have to know the modes of asexual and sexual for each class. Okay. Now here you can see some examples: Rhizopus, Albugo and Mucor. In ascomycetes also the same process happens. If you remember, I had told you that there is a male sex organ. Let me show you in the form of the solid nuclei here. And then I had shown you that there is a hypha, a female hypha, which has the female sex organ here. In same thing happens, the contents of the male sex organ are passed on to the female sex organ. I'm giving you a generalized idea. And then if you take the female sex organ here, the female sex organ will now have male nucleus and female nucleus in it. Male and female, but what has fused? The cytoplasm has undergone fusion. Plasmogamy has happened. Now what happens is the karyogamy does not take place immediately here. Now this female sex organ, which has these two nuclei, one solid and one circular, one hollow, which is the male and female, will now start producing new hyphae. See, on all the sides it will start producing new hyphae, and each of these hyphae will be septate and they will have two nuclei in them. The same two nuclei will be multiplied and will be passed on to each of these hyphae, which are there in the which are a product of what? Plasmogamy, isn't it? Now, in the terminal cells of this hyphae, these are called ascogenous hyphae. In the terminal cell of this hyphae, let me take this terminal cell, the male and the female will merge together. And what is this fusion called where the nuclei fuse? It is called karyogamy, and they undergo meiosis, and like I said, the cell becomes huge and you have these spores which are produced over here, which get rounded off, and these spores are referred to as the ascospores. And this terminal cell becomes a huge balloon-like cell, and this is called an ascus. Did you understand? Karyogamy does not happen in the sex cell. Karyogamy does not happen inside this cell. It happens inside these hyphae. Which cell of the hyphae? The terminal cells of the hyphae. In the terminal cells of the hyphae, there are a lot of more details which I am not delving into details here because of the shortage of time. So in the terminal cells, the two nuclei come together. What do we call the process where the two nuclei fuse? We call it as karyogamy. So the two nuclei come together and they form a zygote nucleus, and the zygote nucleus undergoes meiosis to form ascospores, and this cell, the terminal cell, becomes massive in size and it becomes a sac-like cell. This is called the ascus, and that's why these fungi are referred to as, what are they referred to as? So that's why we call these ascomycetes as what? Sac fungi. Because they have sac-like cells which have ascospores developing inside them. And you find these sac-like cells aggregated in a group. I told you these are the terminal cells of the hyphae, and they are producing ascospores inside. And this kind of a body where you find a group of asci or ascus together is called a fruiting body, or it is called an ascocarp. Alright? Examples include Aspergillus, Claviceps, Neurospora and Penicillium. And of course, ascospores reproduce mostly by these very small and smooth-walled and thin-walled spores, which are referred to as conidia. They have hyphae. The hyphae becomes erect and upright. At the tip of the hyphae, you can find these cells which form a beaded arrangement like this. And these cells which get cut off from this, and this particular structure is a conidia. And the conidia will break open and it will produce a germ tube which will mature into a new hyphae. So these asexual structures which are born on these upright hyphae, and these are called the conidio, these upright or aerial hyphae are called the conidiophore, and these chains of cells, each cell here is referred to as a conidium. Okay, so this is the mode of what? Asexual reproduction. Basidiomycetes also exhibit sexual reproduction predominantly. However, their asexual reproduction spores are missing in them completely. They reproduce only by fragmentation through asexual reproduction. And something unique happens in them. If this is one hypha and if this is another hypha, again, let us say that this has solid nuclei and this has hollow nuclei, and we call this as the male or the plus strain and the female or the minus strain. Each and every cell in the hypha will fuse together, and the resulting hypha, as you can expect, will happen, will have what? Two nuclei, because it is a product of plasmogamy, and this is referred to as the dikaryotic hypha. And do you know that it is this process where there is entire fusion of hypha, this type of sexual reproduction is called somatogamy. And these hypha, which are uninucleate, are called, are belonging to a body called promycelium. So promycelium fuse together to form dikaryotic hypha. It is this dikaryotic hypha that takes the shape of a mushroom that you are very much aware of, and the mushroom produces spores. These spores are called the basidiospores. So what are the sexual spores called? They are called basidiospores. The basidiospores, when they fall on a suitable substratum, they will germinate into a new hypha. Clear? So there is a dikaryotic phase, and in the dikaryotic phase, the mycelium will take shape into a mushroom. So we call this mushroom as a fruiting body, like how in ascomycetes we called it as ascocarp. Here we are going to call it as basidiocarp. The basidiocarp is the one that is going to produce. It is understood that karyogamy takes place. The nuclei ultimately merge together to form what? Zygote nucleus. And will the zygote nucleus simply stay as it is? No, it will undergo meiosis to form special spores called basidiospores. In ascomycetes, it was ascospores. In basidiomycetes, it is called basidiospores. Okay? Examples, Agaricus, Eustilago, Puccinia. Puccinia is the one that causes wheat rust. You should be thorough with each and every example that is given in your NCERT textbooks. Please bear that in mind. Some of the examples of basidiomycetes. Deuteromycetes are called the last division under kingdom mycota or kingdom fungi. They are called imperfect fungi because they do not exhibit any sexual stages. They reproduce only by asexual or vegetative phases. The reproduction is exhibited mostly by conidia, and as of now, if you discover any sexual reproduction phase in them, then you will remove that species from Deuteromycetes and you will put it in some other species, in some other division. Okay? So, but the members of Deuteromycetes do not exhibit sexual reproduction. Mycelium is septate. There are cross walls with the nuclei in between them and they are branched. Correct? Examples include Alternaria, Coletotrichum, Trichoderma and Cercospora. Trichoderma is not a parasite. The others are parasites. We know that fungi also form symbiotic association with algae. Specifically, mostly it is the blue-green algae. Such symbiotic associations form between the fungal hypha or mycelium and algae is referred to as, what do we call it as? We call it as lichens. Okay. Now, what is this? What is the use of the fungus and alga coming together? The alga makes food for the fungus and the fungus provides a protective covering to the alga, and also the fungus, the hypha of the fungus absorbs nutrients and water for the alga. So, both are benefited from each other, isn't it? And they cannot live without each other. So, it is called as mutualism. They are mutually dependent on each other, isn't it? So the alga gives food to the fungus gives water, nutrients and protection. They are called bioindicators because wherever you see lichens, mostly you must have seen lichens growing on the barks of trees, very common to see. And if you see them growing extensively on the bark of trees, you can be rest assured that there is no pollution in the surrounding environment, and they are indicative of sulfur dioxide pollution. Wherever there is more pollution, you will not see these lichens. There are different types of lichens called fruticose lichens, crustose lichens, folios. Fruticose lichens are those lichens which grow as a bunch. So they grow as a bunch or a bush. They are attached to the substratum with an attachment disc. Okay, and crustose lichens, they grow as a crust, as a thin surface on the bark of the trees. And folios lichen are those which grow like, which give the appearance of leaf. So based on their growth pattern, that is whether they grow as a bush with an attachment disc attached to it, or whether they grow as a mat or as a crust, which is very closely oppressed to the surface on which they are growing, or whether they grow as a leaf-like structure, we can classify them as fruticose, crustose and folios. Example for fruticose is usnea. Example for crustose is rhizocarpon. Example for folios is parmelia. Okay, so with this we end the lecture, the crash course synopsis of both the chapter diversity of living world as well as of biological classification. So I wish you all the very best in your preparation for your upcoming NEET exam. So have a good time and take care all of you. Thank you. So welcome to Deeksha Online all of you for NEET crash course 2020, and now we are going to discuss about the next chapter in today's NEET crash course, that is Animal Kingdom. Now, Kingdom Animalia, as you all are aware, it includes heterotrophic and eukaryotic organisms. And we have to learn some of the fundamental features of animals before getting into the details of the Animal Kingdom. So one by one, let us delve with the fundamental aspects of Animal Kingdom. So you know the different levels of organization. Now, animals may be cellular. They may have a group of cells which are not forming a tissue, like in the case of sponges. Cells may come together and they perform a similar function and they exhibit similar structure. Then we call them as tissues, like it starts from sealant rata. And then we have tissues which come together to form organ. The first phylum to exhibit organ level of organization is Platyhelminthes. And however, organ system level of organization is, as you all are aware, it is the roundworms. So these are the different levels of organization. Then moving on to symmetry, body symmetry. Now body symmetry refers to how the different parts of the body are arranged with respect to a common axis, with respect to a body axis. If you cannot divide the body into two equal halves along any plane, then they are asymmetrical. Please learn the examples also, amoeba, snail and sponges. If you can divide them into similar parts, they are called symmetrical. There are two types of symmetry, that is radial symmetry and bilateral symmetry. Now, if an organism is radially symmetrical, then any plane passing through this central, this dot represents the central axis, any plane passing through the central axis can divide the body of the animal into two equal halves. But if it is bilaterally symmetrical, say for example if it is a planaria or a worm, then there is only one plane along which you can divide the body of the organism into two equal halves, and then we call it as bilateral symmetry. So radial symmetry and bilateral symmetry are the two major types of symmetry you must remember. Examples for radial symmetry are coelenterates, ctenophores and echinoderms, and bilateral symmetry, all vertebrates, however, it starts with, you have some of the nematodes, that is Aeschylminthes and Annelida, Arthropoda, etc. So here you can see the example. Now this is the central axis. You are cutting it along the central axis. Along any plane that passes through the central axis, you get two equal halves. Whereas if you see a turtle, there is only one plane along the midline of the body, which gives you two equal halves. And if you see a sponge, you cannot divide it into two similar parts along any plane, and that's why it is asymmetrical. Body layers are diploblastic and triploblastic. Now you have taken a section, so imagine the body is cylindrical like this, and when you cut open the body, you can see different layers. The cells in the body are arranged into different layers. If the cells are arranged into two layers, then we call them as diploblastic. For example, there is an inner layer that is called endoderm and an outer layer called ectoderm. However, here you can see an additional layer, that is the mesoderm. So there is outer ectoderm, middle mesoderm, inner endoderm. So if the body wall of an organism consists of cells which are arranged in three distinct layers, then we call it as triploblastic. We call these layers as germ layers because they are first forming during the embryonic development. Then we have coelomates. If the organism has a true coelom, then we refer to it as a coelomate. Now, what is a true coelom? It should be lined with mesoderm on both sides. For example, you have taken a section of the body of an animal. You see the ectoderm, okay? This is the ectoderm which I have shown, and this is the endoderm which is lined, which is lining the gut. The cavity here is called the gut, okay? And then you have two coelomic spaces on both the sides, and this is lined by the middle layer, which is referred to as the mesoderm. So such a lining, such a cavity that is lined with mesoderm on both sides is referred to as a true coelom. So it is lined both on the inside and on the outside by this middle layer. The middle layer is what is referred to as mesoderm. So this kind of an organization, this kind of an animal is said to be a coelomate. Examples for coelomates are annelids, mollusks, arthropods, echinoderms and hemichordates, and including the members of phylum Chordata, including ourselves. Pseudocoelomates, in the sense the coelom is not lined with mesoderm and the mesoderm is present in the form of scattered pouches. So for example, this is the ectoderm, this is the endoderm, and the mesoderm is present in the form of pouches like this. So this cavity that you see here, on the inside there is endoderm, on the outside there is ectoderm, so you call this as a false coelom. And why it is not considered a true coelom? Because the mesoderm does not line this coelom. It is present in the form of scattered pouches in the space between the outer ectoderm and the inner endoderm. This is seen in the case of Aeschylminthes. However, if coelom is missing, like in the case of Platyhelminthes, then we say that the animal is a acoelomate. Okay. Segmentation. In some animals, you can see that the body is divided into repeated external and internal segments, like in the case of earthworms. It is called metamerism or segmentation. Notochord, in some animals, now if you consider a chordate organism, on the dorsal side of the body, this is the dorsal, this is the ventral, this is anterior, this is posterior. So on the dorsal side of the body, you see a solid supporting rod-like structure. This solid supporting rod-like structure is referred to as the notochord. Now this notochord provides mechanical support to the body, and it is actually derived from the mesoderm during the early embryonic development. And animals which do not possess notochord are referred to as the non-chordates. And above the notochord, you have another structure which is referred to as the nerve cord. There's another cylindrical structure, a hollow cylindrical structure. So the notochord is not hollow, whereas this upper tube which I'm showing is a hollow cylindrical structure, which is referred to as the nerve cord, whereas the lower one that is present below the nerve cord, which is solid supporting rod-like structure, is referred to as the notochord. Okay. Classification of animals. So you can see we have classified animals So they belong to kingdom Animalia. The two levels of organization we have broadly classified it into cellular level, and the advanced levels are put together: tissue, organ, and organ system level of organization. There is only one phylum under cellular level, that is Porifera. Under tissue, organ, and organ system level, they can further be classified based on their symmetry. Under radial symmetry, you have phylum Coelentrata, phylum Ctenophora, which is comb jellies, and under bilateral symmetry, you have animals which do not have. So again, you're classifying symmetry based on body cavity or coelom. So acoelomates, pseudocoelomate, false coelom, and coelomates, which usually have a true coelom that is lined with mesoderm on both sides. Now this table is extremely important for your NEET exam, because this table is there in your NCERT exam. They can pick this table, they can ask you this in the form of fill in the blanks, or they can omit some of the text in this and they can ask you to choose the correct option. So it is very important you are thorough with this table. You have to learn all the examples, you have to revise. You've learned all of this in your first year, so you have to revise all of these phyla to which each of them belong to. Okay, now moving on to a very quick recap of what are the different phyla, invertebrate phyla we will start off with. First of all, we start off with Porifera. Now in Porifera, some of the words you need to remember is the body has openings, minute openings called ostia. There is one single large opening called osculum, and what enters through the ostia, the seawater enters through the ostia, and this system is called the water canal system. There is a central cavity in the body. What is the central cavity in the body called? It is called the spongocoel or the paragastrocoel cavity, isn't it? The body wall is diploblastic. They have an outer layer called pinacoderm and an inner layer called choanoderm. It is very important to note that the choanoderm has cells which have a collar like structure, which is actually microvilli, and they have a flagella in the center like this, and these are referred to as the collar cells. The presence of collar cells, which are also called the choanocyte, is a very important feature of phylum Porifera. They're holozoic, their digestion happens inside their body cells, intracellular. They have spicules and spongin fibers for their mechanical support. They undergo budding or gemmule, and fertilization happens internally, that is the sperm and the egg fuse inside the body. They are hermaphroditic. Now that is not mentioned here. It is important to remember that most of the sponges are hermaphroditic, that is that this is a term that is used to denote what condition? It is used to denote bisexual condition. And we say that development is indirect because there is a larval stage, and they also exhibit a very high power of regeneration. Example, Cycon. Cycon is called the urn sponge. Okay, so Cycon or Scypha, and then you Spongia or bath sponge. Spongilla is the only freshwater sponge which mostly exhibits these structures, which are perinating structures to tide over unfavorable condition called gemmules. Coelentrata. How is Coelentrata advanced? I think Coelentrata is the first phylum to exhibit the tissue grade of organization or tissue level of organization. Okay, and they are marine. They may be sessile or free swimming. Sessile means they're always fixed to the substratum. They're radially symmetrical. They also have two layers in their body wall separated by a gelatinous substance called mesoglia. Okay, the two layers are outer epidermis, inner gastrodermis, and one important thing, very important thing, is they exhibit two basic body forms. One is called a polyp. Now you all are aware how a polyp is. It is cylindrical and it has a crown of tentacles on it, isn't it? Now this is a polyp, and medusa is umbrella shaped, like you all have seen jellyfishes. Okay, so two forms of body can be seen. One is called the polyp or the hydrant, and one is umbrella shape, which is called medusa. Now example for polyp is Adamsia and Hydra, and for medusa it is jellyfish. And you also have heard about alternation of generation. There are some animals, for example you have Obelia. Now Obelia is commonly called sea fur. It can exist both as a polyp as well as a medusa, and it exhibits a very unique type of a life cycle called metagenesis. Now what happens in metagenesis? Now this is something very important with regard to Coelentrata. You have the polyp state. The polyp state reproduces asexually to give rise to the medusa. The medusa, which are set free, reproduce sexually to give rise to polyp. So sexual reproduction is undertaken by medusa and asexual reproduction is undertaken by polyp. And this alternation of generation, alternation of sexual and asexual generations is called metagenesis. Then they have stinging cells called nidoblasts or nematoblasts. So basically they have a stinging cell with a stinging apparatus inside. The stinging apparatus or the stinging capsule is called a cyst. So don't get confused between nematocyst and nematoblast. If you hear the word cyst, it is the capsule. Suppose this is the cell. Then inside the cell there is a capsule where there is a coiled thread with poison inside. Okay, this capsule is called a cyst, and the cell which has a nucleus and cytoplasm and all that is called a blast. So you can also call this capsule as a nidocyst, whereas the cell is referred to as a nidoblast or a nematoblast. And you can imagine there is a trigger on top that is called the nidocell. If this nidocell comes into contact with another organism such as the prey, then you can see this thread will get shot out like this, and the thread is very sharp and it pierces into the prey and delivers a paralytic toxin. That's why this is called nidaria, because they have stinging cells which are called nidoblasts or nematoblasts containing the stinging capsule called nidocyte or nematocyte. And like I told you that diploblastic, they have a jelly-like substance or layer between the two layers of outer ectoderm and inner endoderm, and this gelatinous layer is called mesoglia. And then they have gastrovascular cavity. For example, if this is the Hydra, the body of Hydra, it is columnar, and then there is an elevated region upon which there is mouth, and there is a crown of tentacles like this. Surrounding the mouth, there is a crown of tentacles. This elevated ridge up below the mouth is referred to as the hypostome. Okay, and then you have to remember that they have a cavity inside. The cavity is referred to as the gastrovascular cavity or the coelenteron. Please note this. And then we saw that there are two layers in the body wall. The outer layer is called the ectoderm, or it is called the epidermis, and the inner layer is basically derived from the endoderm. It is called the gastrodermis. So the ectoderm gives rise to the epidermis, which is the outermost layer of the body wall, and the endoderm gives rise to the gastrodermis, which is the inner layer of the body wall. And like I told you, between the two layers there is a gelatinous matrix, and this gelatinous matrix is called the mesoglia. Okay, fine. So what are the examples of phylum Coelenterata? You have Physalia, Adamsia or sea animal. Physalia is called the Portuguese man of war because it's like the war machine. It is loaded with batteries and batteries of stinging cells. That's why it's called the Portuguese man of war. Pennatula is the sea pen. Gorgonia is the sea fan. Meandrina is the brain coral. And I would like to mention that there are some corals, mostly corals are polyps. And now imagine this is a polyp. It secretes. So I'm focusing on this polyp here. Now it secretes a calcium carbonate shell on its outside. And this calcium carbonate shell is what becomes the coral. And generally coral is not one polyp, it is many polyps which are living together. Okay, Ctenophora is also called comb jelly, and you are aware that they are called comb jelly because they have a spherical body. They have an apical, an aboral pole and an oral pole where mouth is present. On the aboral pole, they have two openings called anus, anal pores are there. And they have a special sense organ which helps in balancing the body called statocyst. Extending from the oral to the aboral pole, there are how many rows of comb plates? There are 8 meridional rows. I've shown 4 over here, but imagine there will be 8 of them, and along these rows you can see these paddle like structures. And if you were to magnify these paddle like structures, you would see that they are paddles with cilia at their free margin, and therefore they look like a comb, and these paddles will flip upwards and downwards, and it will help the animal to swim in water. Digestion is both extracellular, intracellular. It also has tissue level of organization. The organization is very similar to what we saw in case of Coelenterata. They also have an outer ectoderm, outer epidermis and inner gastrodermis. So they have locomotory structures which I mentioned over here, which is referred to as comb plates, and mouth opens into a stomodium. A stomodium is a special layer which is lined with a canal lined with ectoderm on the inside, and then it opens into a broad cavity, and this broad cavity is called the gastrovascular cavity, which give out radial canals on both sides. So inside the mouth there is a stomodium which leads into the gastrovascular cavity. Just like Coelenteron, the gastrovascular cavity is also called what is it called? Seal and teron. But here we don't use the word seal and teron. We just use the word that is gastrovascular cavity. And then on both sides of the animal's body, there are tentacular sheaths which bear elongated tentacles. However, these tentacles bear branches which do not have stinging cells, but they have certain other special cells. These special cells are glue secreting cells. They are called coloblasts. Coloblasts or lasso cells. Okay, and now coming to their reproduction, they also exhibit bioluminescence. They can emit light in darkness. Sexes are not separate, they are hermaphroditic. Reproduction takes place only by sexual means. Fertilization is external, that means the sperm and the egg meet in the surrounding water, not inside the body of the parent. And there is indirect development because there is a developmental larval stage. Example is Pleurobrachia and Tenoplana. Platyhelminthes are dorsoventrally flattened body. You know that they are called flatworms. You can think of tapeworm and liver fluke, isn't it? They exhibit organs. So this is the first phylum to exhibit organ level of organization. They live inside the body of the host, endoparasites. That's the reason why they have a flat body, because it will help them to navigate easily. What are some of the parasitic adaptations that you can think about when you talk about phylum Platyhelminthes? So you have that they have adhesive organs like hooks and suckers. They have a tough cuticle on the outside. They don't have sense organs. They are hermaphroditic. Sexes are united. What is the use of having united sexes? They don't have to go looking around for the opposite sex for mating, isn't it? So they can reproduce very easily. Then they have an incomplete alimentary canal. Some of them don't even have a mouth. Like for example, tapeworm doesn't have a digestive system because they can directly absorb nutrition through their skin surface. They exhibit a saprozoic nutrition. And then they have special cells called flame cells or protonephridia, which carry out excretion and osmoregulation. And these are also the first animals which show germs of cephalization, because a few of the anterior segments organize themselves roughly into a structure which you can call it as head. Okay. Organs of locomotion are absent. Again, like I said, one of the parasitic adaptations is that they are hermaphroditic. Fertilization happens inside the body of the parent organism. And one of the examples of the free-living Platyhelminth, not all Platyhelminthes are parasitic. You should remember that one thing. So some of the free-living Platyhelminths like Planaria, that they exhibit a very high regenerative capacity. And if you talk about the parasitic forms, Tinea solium, which is the pork tapeworm, and then you have Fasciola hepatica, which is the liver fluke. Okay, now liver fluke, as you all are aware, it requires, it mostly attacks what is called the sheep, and it requires a snail in order to complete its life cycle. Askelminthes, they are also called roundworms, because if you take a section, they appear round in section. That's why they are referred to as roundworms. They have a cylindrical, unsegmented and thread-like body. Okay, they are bilaterally symmetrical, triploblastic and pseudocoelomate. But please remember, this is the first phylum to exhibit organ system level of organization. Alright, and then they have excretory tubes in their body which help in removing excretory waste. Intracellular tubes are present. They are dioecious, meaning sexes are separate, and sexual dimorphism is very clear. Fertilization happens inside the body of the female. Development may be direct if there is no larval stage, or it may be indirect with larval stage. Examples are Ascaris, which is commonly called roundworm, Wuchereria, which is commonly called filarial worm, that is transmitted by the female Culex mosquito, whereas Ascaris, the roundworm, is transmitted by contaminated food and water. Ankylostoma or hookworm is also transmitted directly through by walking barefooted. The larva can bore into the skin of the person. So basically you have a lot of parasites which are included under this phylum called phylum Askelminthes or Nematelminthes. Okay, phylum Annelida, what is the unique nature of Annelida? They are free living, or they may be ectoparasites. They are coelomate. They also have an organ system level of organization. You've seen the body of earthworm, how its body is divided into ring like segments, isn't it? So the body consists of metameric segmentation. This is something which is unique to phylum Annelida. They have both longitudinal muscles in the body which run along the length of the body, as well as circular muscles which run along the horizontal or along the
circumference of the body, and then you have some of the animals which are nereus. Nereus is actually unisexual. Not all of them are unisexual, or sexes are not separate in all of them, but in nereus the sexes are separate and they have special fleshy appendages. For example, if these are the segments of nereus, you can see fleshy appendages on both sides, and these fleshy appendages bear bristle like structures on them. Now these structures which help this worm, since this worm lives in the sea, it acts as paddle, it helps in locomotion. These are called parapodia. If you see earthworm, on each segment there are S-shaped chitinous structures. These S-shaped chitinous structures are called as setae. They help in getting a grip on the soil when the earthworm is burrowing in the soil. They have a complete digestive system with mouth and anus, a closed circulatory system. They have, now usually if you take earthworm, you have four pairs of hearts in earthworm, isn't it? So basically you have a closed circulatory system which helps in, and you have nephridia. The excretory structure is nephridia, which help in both osmoregulation and excretion. Neural system consists of paired ganglia which are connected by lateral nerves and double ventral nerve cord. And one thing you should remember is, if this is the body of the earthworm from the side view you're looking at, and if this is the digestive system, say this is the buccal cavity, this is the pharynx, and this is the esophagus, all of you remember, you will find these ganglia which are paired swollen structures above the pharynx. It's called suprapharyngeal ganglia. And then from both the ganglia you have these connectives which come down, and below the pharynx they unite together to form subpharyngeal, which are a paired ganglia called subpharyngeal ganglia. And then on the ventral side you have double ventral. See, two nerve cords are originating from the subpharyngeal ganglia, and at every regular interval you have abdominal or the segmental ganglia. So this is called a double ventral nerve cord. And since these two structures, which are called the primitive brain, these are located above the pharynx, we call them as cerebral ganglia, or the correct word to use is suprapharyngeal, because it is above the pharynx. Nereus, like I said, is an aquatic form which is dioecious, meaning the sexes are separate, whereas earthworm and leeches are both monoecious. In case of nereus, fertilization is external. In case of leech, fertilization is internal. In leech, development is direct. In nereus it is indirect, because it includes a larva called trochophore larva. See, a free living trochophore larva. Nereus is commonly called the bristle worm or the sandworm, and Ferritima is commonly called earthworm, and Hirudinaria is the blood sucking leech. Largest phylum of the animal kingdom is phylum Arthropoda, the most ubiquitous, the most cosmopolitan phylum in animal kingdom. Organ system level, bilateral symmetry, triploblastic, but most important thing, this is the first phylum to have invaded the land entirely, and these are the first phylum which include animals which developed a pair of wings, like insects for the first time took to the air, isn't it? So what made them so capable of invading land? Because they had an exoskeleton. Their body has a covering on the outside which is called cuticle, which is heavily deposited with a pigment, with a substance called chitin. They possess jointed appendages, orthros meaning jointed and podos meaning legs. The leg is not a single unit, but it is consisting of several segments joined together. Their body consists of three divisions. This is called tagmosis. The body exhibits a phenomenon called tagmosis, where you can divide the body into head, thorax and abdomen. Respiratory organs, like in case of aquatic forms it is gills. In case of horseshoe crab or king crab, which is a living fossil, you have book gills. Then there are book lungs in the case of aquatic terrestrial arachnids like scorpion. And in insects, especially terrestrial forms, you have tracheal system, which are tubes which carry air in them. They have a complete digestive system, and circulatory system is open. Very important. There are no blood vessels, and the blood is freely flowing inside the body cavity. Such a body cavity that is filled with the blood is referred to as the hemocoel. So we say that the coelome, or the body cavity in these organisms, is called a hemocoel, because blood is freely circulating within the hemocoel. Okay. Sensory organs are present. Excretion through malpighian tubules, very important. The structures of excretion in Arthropoda are malpighian tubules. Sexes are separate.
they are dioecious, and fertilization, usually there is transfer of sperm from the male into the female reproductive tract, which is called internal fertilization. Females lay eggs, and that's why females are called oviparous. Sometimes there are larval stages when we say that the development is indirect. If there is no larval stage, we say that the development is direct. It's very important to learn these examples, economically important examples like Apis, Bombyx and Lachifer, vectors which spread diseases like Anopheles, Culex and Aedes, gregarious pests which cause damage to agricultural crops like in the case of Locusta, and living fossil which is Limulus, which is horseshoe crab or king crab. And Limulus is the one which is called a living fossil because it has retained some of its ancestral traits over the course of evolution. Okay. Mollusca, it is the second largest phylum. So the first largest phylum is Arthropoda, the second largest phylum is Mollusca. Now, important thing is the body of mollusks is covered by a shell and it has three parts. For example, if you take, this is the head of the mollusk, and then you have the body which is extended into a fold like this, and then you have the main part with a foot like this. And this is called the visceral hump, where much of the body parts are present. This is the head and this is the foot. And what is this extension of the skin, this fleshy fold on the body? This is called the mantle. And the mantle is the one that secretes what on its outside? That secretes a shell that is made up of calcium carbonate. And can you see the space between the mantle and the visceral hump? This is called the mantle cavity. In this mantle cavity, you will find feather-shaped gills, which are referred to as tenidia, which help in respiration. Also openings of the nephridia, which is the excretory structure, openings of the digestive system, which is the anus. All of these openings are found in this cavity called the mantle cavity. And the head has sensory tentacles. As you can see in the snail, there are tentacles which originate in eye spots. And then most importantly, inside the mouth, if you see the mouth of this particular organism, now let me show you here. Imagine that it is opening its mouth. It is opening a tongue-like structure, which is a long tape-like, a file-like, a very sharp chitinous structure, which is referred to as the radula. The radula helps in scraping the food. It is called as a rasping organ. The file-like rasping organ, which is provided with several chitinous teeth, like how we have tongue. They have an elongated ribbon-like chitinous structure which have lot of chitinous teeth on them, that is called radula. Then feather-like gills, like I told you, or in some cases there may be an opening, like say for example here there is an opening which leads into a huge sac where air or gaseous exchange takes place, and such sacs are referred to as the pulmonary sacs. Okay. Open type of circulatory system, there is no blood vessels, and blood may contain copper containing pigment that is referred to as hemocyanin. They are mostly unisexual, of course bisexual forms are also there. Oviparous, the female lay egg, and fertilization may happen in the outside environment or it may happen inside the female body. The Apila is the apple snail, Pinctada is the pearl oyster, Sepia is the cuttlefish, Loligo is the squid, Octopus is commonly called the devilfish, Aplysia is the sea hare, Dentalium is the tusk shell, Ketoplura is chiton. So please remember, these are the common names also. Okay, so octopus is the devilfish, Aplysia is the sea hare. Okay. And then moving on to phylum Echinodermata, the body is covered with lot of spines, that's why it is called Echinodermata. Another unique feature is adults are radially symmetrical, like a starfish with five arms is radially symmetrical, but the larvae are bilaterally symmetrical. They have a complete digestive system with mouth on the ventral surface and anus on the upper or the aboral surface. They have a tube, a network of tubes which are circulating inside the body which carry seawater in them. This is called the ambulacral system. The opening of the ambulacral system is a mesh-like opening which is referred to as the mandriporite. So if you see the starfish, it has five arms like this. Now this surface where you find anus is the aboral surface. On the undersurface there is mouth in the center, which is the aboral surface. Close to the anus there will be a structure with a mesh-like structure
network on it, which is referred to as the madreporite. The madreporite leads into tubes on the inside and which carry water into these pipelines. There are a lot of pipelines inside. There is a ring and there are tubes given out into each of these arms, which are referred to as the radial canals. And then from the radial canals, you can see the tubes which originate on the sides, which are called lateral canals. And from the lateral canals, let me magnify here, there is a balloon-like structure which originates, which is referred to as the tube feet, with which the starfish walks, isn't it? It walks on the seafloor. Now, whenever it takes the seawater into this madreporite, the seawater gets filled into this balloon-like structure, and it makes this balloon-like structure very sturdy. And this feet-like portion, which has a sucker at its end to hold on to the substratum, it uses this tube feet in order to move. So there are a lot of tube feet on the undersurface of the body of a starfish. Okay. Endoskeleton, then just beneath the skin, they have numerous calcareous plates called ossicles. So they basically, you can call it as endoskeleton because it is beneath the skin. Excretory system is absent, but they show a high power of regeneration. Very important to note that probably by simple diffusion, and just now we talked about the water vascular system or the ambulacral system, which may help in transport of excretory waste into the surrounding seawater. They are obviously, sexes are separate. There is no sexual dimorphism, and fertilization as a rule is always external. Development is indirect, because there are larval stages before it forms the adult. Asterius is the starfish, Echinus is the sea urchin, Antidon is the sea lily, Cucumeria is the sea cucumber, and Ophiura is the brittle star. Okay, so these are the examples you need to know. Hemichordata was earlier included under chordata, that's why the name is Hemichordata here. But later they identified, they had seen that in this animal which has a collar, which has a proboscis, this structure is called the proboscis, and then a collar, and then it has a body, and then so this is basically the body with two flaps of skin like this, and with gills at its end on its either sides. So in the proboscis, they saw that these scientists had discovered a rod-like structure extending into the proboscis from the collar, and they thought it is notochord, but later they identified it is not the notochord. They called it the stomochord because it was present at the roof of the mouth, and this stomochord later came to be known as the buccal diverticulum, and therefore they later decided, okay, this is not the notochord, so we should not place it in chordata, we should place it under non-chordata or invertebrata. They exhibit bilateral symmetry, triploblastic, coelomate animals, and they have organ system level of organization. I told you that they have many pairs of gill openings in the form of paired openings on the dorsal side of the body. So what you're seeing here is the dorsal side of the body. Okay. Circulatory system is of open type, and in the proboscis they have a special gland which is referred to as the proboscis gland, which helps in excretion. Sexes are separate, and fertilization happens in the outside water, and development is indirect because there is involvement of larva. And the examples include balanoglossus or sacoglossus. So now moving on to the next major phylum, which is referred to as the phylum Chordata, to which we belong. So we have, now if you imagine this to be the hypothetical chordate that I started off in the beginning of this chapter, we have a dorsal tubular nerve cord, which is hollow, a dorsal solid supporting rod-like structure, which is called notochord, and in our pharynx or the throat region, we have gills, and then we have there is anus, which is the opening of our digestive system. Beyond the anus, we have a tail. And most importantly, if this is the ventral side, on the ventral side of the body, we have a heart. So having a dorsal hollow nerve cord, a dorsal solid supporting rod-like notochord, having pharyngeal gill slits, having a ventral heart, having a postanal tail, these are some of the features of phylum Chordata. Now phylum Chordata is divided into several subphylum. Some of them is Urochordata and Cephalochordata, based on how often or how long do we retain the structure that develops during our embryonic development called notochord. In Urochordata, the notochord is present in the larval tail, but it is lost as the adult. Once the young one becomes an adult,
Once the larva becomes the adult, it loses its notochord, it loses its tail also. Since originally the notochord is present in the tail, uro means tail, it's called urochordata. In cephalochordata, the notochord is retained throughout the life of the organism. It doesn't lose the notochord. And the third and the major subphylum that we talk about in this particular case is subphylum vertebrata. What is so unique about vertebrata? How are they different from urochordata and cephalochordata? Just now I mentioned to you, in urochordata, the notochord is present only in the larval tail. It is lost in the adult. In cephalochordata, they are persistent throughout the life. In vertebrata, what happens is during our embryonic development, we possess a notochord. So notochord is formed during our embryonic development. But once the embryo develops into a young one, after the embryonic development, the notochord is replaced by a structure that is referred to as the vertebral column. So since in us, we don't have notochord throughout our life, the notochord is replaced by vertebral column. We call us as vertebrata. And these two, that is urochordata and cephalochordata, are collectively referred to as protochordata, primitive chordates. Now in subphylum vertebrata, we have two types of division. Now the first division is called agnatha. They don't have jaw. These are jawless vertebrates. So important to note, these are referred to as the jawless vertebrates. The jawless vertebrates, under them we have only one living class today, that is Cyclostomata. They have a circular mouth, they don't have jaws, and they have skin without scales, and they are slimy. That's why they are not fishes. They have endoskeleton, which is cartilaginous. They have exoskeleton, that is scales are completely absent. Closed circulation, two-chambered heart, very similar to fishes, but they are not fishes, because fishes have jaws, but these creatures don't have jaws. Cyclostomes are marine, but migrate to the freshwater for spawning, that is to lay the eggs. Once the male and the female reproduce in the fresh water, within days the male and the female die out, and then the eggs hatch out into the larva. The larva undergo metamorphosis in the river and it comes back to the ocean. Okay, so the adults have to migrate to the rivers in order to lay the egg and deposit the sperm. Once the eggs hatch, the larvae will undergo metamorphosis into the young one, and after it metamorphoses, the young one swims back into the ocean. Example is Petromyzon, which is lamprey, and Myxene, which is hagfish. Now moving to superclass Pisces. Now here the topics, the titles are not mentioned accurately. So now we are moving to the next division, the division Gnathostomata. Gnathostomata means we possess, the animals that possess jaws. Okay, so animals that possess jaws are coming under Gnathostomata, and under Gnathostomata we are now talking about superclass Pisces. And under superclass Pisces, we are talking about class Chondrichthyes. Class Chondrichthyes are nothing but cartilaginous fishes. They have cartilage in their skeleton instead of bone. There are two types of classes under superclass Pisces. One is class Chondrichthyes and one is class Osteichthyes. So subsequently we will learn about Osteichthyes as well. So Chondrichthyes, how are they different? Because they have a cartilaginous endoskeleton. They have placoid scales, which are very very minute and tridentate scales on the body, which are barely visible to the naked eye. And they have to keep swimming in water because they don't possess an air bladder. Normally in bony fishes they have an air bladder. Suppose they keep stop swimming, they don't sink because the air bladder is filled with air. But these Chondrichthyes do not have air bladders in them. Okay, so then you have gill slits are separate without operculum, and then you have the gill slits which are separate without operculum and gill cover, and then you have mouth which is ventral, and alimentary canal opens into the cloacal aperture, and they have a notochord which is persistent throughout their life. Very very important, the notochord remains throughout their life. Okay, some of them have electric organs, like for example you have torpedo, and some of them have poisonous sting. For example, you have the stingray. Now this torpedo is referred to as the electric ray, and trigon is referred to as the stingray. Okay, they are cold-blooded because they are poikilothermous. They don't have the ability to maintain their body temperature. Their heart is two-chambered. Their sexes are separate. Males will have special structures to transfer the sperm into the body of the female called claspers or copulatory organs. And very important, the males transport the sperm into the body of the female internal fertilization, and the females are generally... There are viviparous members also. There are generally oviparous, but most of the sharks are viviparous because they give birth to live young ones. Isn't it? Scoliodon is the dogfish and Pristis is the sawfish. Carcharodon is the great white shark and Trigon is the stingray. Now, osteichthyes, like I told you, again belongs to superclass Pisces, but it includes bony endoskeleton. And they can swim in water with the help of fins, and their fins are supported with cartilaginous and bony rays, or rays are nothing but the bony supports which are present in the fins. Okay, and they have a gill which is covered with an operculum or the gill cover. Air bladder is present, heart is two-chambered. They are cold-blooded or poikilothermic. Their sexes are separate. Fertilization is usually external. That is, the male and the female liberate the sperm and the egg to the outside environment where fertilization takes place. They are mostly oviparous or egg-laying, and development does not involve a larval stage. It is direct. So you have marine forms like Exocetus. You have hippocampus, seahorse, freshwater forms which are edible like Labio, Catla, Clarius, aquarium fishes like Betta, which is the fighting fish, and pterophyllum, which is the angel fish. So amphibia, now amphibians have originated from water, from the Pisces, from the fishes, and amphibians live on both water as well as in land, and they have two pairs of pentadactyl limbs. Pentadactyl meaning they have digits which are five. Usually they have five digits in their four limbs and only four in their four digits in their four limbs and five digits in their hind limbs, and they don't have nails or claws, but they have webbed digits to help them use their limbs as paddles in water. Their body is divisible into head and trunk. Neck is absent. They're cold-blooded. They have protrusible sticky tongue. Their skin is moist. They don't have scales. They have eyelids. Eyes have eyelids, and they have a transparent eyelid called nictitating membrane. Their external ear has an eardrum behind their eye, which is called the tympanum. They have all their alimentary canal, digestive system, excretory system, reproductive system opening into a common passage. So if this is the opening, this is a common chamber. So into this opens the digestive system, into this opens the excretory system, into this opens the reproductive system, and all the material collect in this chamber and are then excreted out. So this is referred to as a common chamber, that is called the cloacal chamber. The opening of the cloacal chamber is called the cloacal aperture. They have cutaneous respiration. They can breathe through their skin. They can breathe through their mouth and their pharyngeal lining. They can breathe through gills like in case of tadpoles. They have three chambers in their heart, two upper chambers and one lower chamber. Sexes are separate. Male and female deposit their gametes in the surrounding water. Water medium is required for fertilization. Females deposit eggs which are called oviparous, and development is indirect because there is involvement of tadpole larva. Isn't it? So examples include bufo or toad, rana or frog, hyla tree frog, salamandra salamander. Ichthyophis is a worm-like creature. It looks more like a worm, but it does not have limbs. It is actually an amphibian, and it is referred to as a limbless amphibian. Reptilia is derived from the Latin word repier or reptum, which is to creep and crawl. The skin is dry and non-glandular. This is one of the reasons why they were successful in making their in invading the land. These were the animals which completely became well adapted to land because they had dry skin. They didn't lose water when they moved on to land, isn't it? And then they have similar teeth, and they have an external ear or eardrum. They move on their limbs. They have tail, they have neck in their body, and they also have claws. And they have lungs and other important terrestrial adaptation. They have bones in their endoskeleton, isn't it? And heart is three-chambered, but in crocodiles it is four-chambered. They are poikilotherms. They cannot regulate their body temperature. Some of them shed their scale in the form of a cast, like in the case of snakes and lizards. Their sexes are separate. Fertilization happens inside the female body. The females lay eggs which are covered with a hard shell. That's why we call such eggs as cladoic eggs. And then the development is direct because the young one hatches out of the egg, it is not a larval stage. Chelon is turtle, testudo is tortoise, chameleon is tree lizard, calotus is the scientific name of garden lizard, crocodilus is crocodile, alligator is alligator, the name is the same, hemidactylus is the common domestic wall lizard, and then you have poisonous snakes like naja, that is cobra, bangaris, that is crate, and vipera, that is viper. Aves, one of the most important thing is they have a boat shaped streamlined body and they are adapted for flight because they have their forelimbs are modified into wings, isn't it? See, forelimbs are modified into wings. They have feathers on their body which makes their body very light. They have only oil glands at the base of their tail which are called uropygial glands. They don't have sweat glands. Their bones are fully ossified but they are pneumatic. They are hollow and filled with air. Their mouth is covered by a beak which also helps in cutting through the air and it provides aerodynamic property to their body. Digestive tract has additional chambers to store the food called crop and gizzard. Gizzard crop, sometimes some birds produce milk from crop like in the case of pigeon, and they regurgitate the milk to feed the young one or the hatchlings that are there in the nest. Okay, they have lungs which are supported by air sacs. Air sacs increase the efficiency of respiration and also makes their body lighter so that they can take to the air easily. Heart is completely four chambered. Okay, now similar to mammals, their heart is completely four-chambered. They're warm-blooded animals. They're able to maintain a constant body temperature. Their sexes are separate. That is, the male and the female sexes are separate. They do not have copulatory structures except in the case of flightless birds where males have copulatory structures. And basically, fertilization happens when the cloaca of the male and the female come together and the male transfers the sperm. This is called cloacal apposition. And then females lay hard calcareous eggs which are called cladoic eggs with lot of yolk in them. So we say that the females are oviparous. So Corvus is crow, Columba is pigeon, Sitacula is parrot, then Struthio is ostrich, Neophron is vulture, and Aptenodytes is penguin. Examples are the most important thing in this chapter. Note down all the examples, both scientific and common name, and ensure that you are 100% thorough with the examples. The last class, the most advanced class in phylum Chordata, subphylum Vertebrata, is class Mammalia, to which we belong, isn't it? Now, we are cosmopolitan. We have adapted to, or mammals are found in almost all habitats on this planet. One of the reasons being they have the ability to maintain a constant internal temperature. They are not cold-blooded. They are warm-blooded. Even birds are warm-blooded, isn't it? Their skin is glandular. They have oil glands. We have sweat glands on our skin. And we also have milk producing mammary glands. We have different types of teeth. That's why we call our dentition or as heterodont, different sets of teeth. We have canines to tear the food. We have incisors to cut the food. We have molars and premolars to grind the food, isn't it? Thecodont, because our teeth are lodged in sockets in our jaws. That is called thecodont. They are not directly attached to the bone in our jaws. Diphyodont, because we develop two sets of teeth in our life. Okay, we have an external ear pinna, which is again very unique to us mammals, and we are homeothermous. Like I said, we can regulate a constant internal body temperature. We exhibit pulmonary respiration because we possess a pair of muscular lungs, and we have a voice box which is called larynx. Now, it is important to know that the previous class, that is birds, they have a special song box which is referred to as the syrinx. So we have a voice box, whereas birds have a song box which is referred to as the syrinx. And then we have epiglottis, which makes sure that when we swallow food or water, it doesn't enter into our windpipe. We have a lot of different varieties of exoskeleton. We have hair, we have fur, and we have claws, we have horns and hoofs, etc. And we are having limbs which are adapted to perform a variety of functions. We generally show sexual dimorphism. Males do have copulatory structures to inseminate the female during coitus. Fertilization happens inside the female reproductive tract. Females are generally viviparous and they may be placentals also. So there are some exceptions to this viviparity. There are animals under class Mammalia which lay eggs. These animals are referred to as oviparous. For example, you have platypus, which is Ornithorhynchus is the scientific name of the duckbill platypus. Then you have a variety of examples that you need to remember. You have Macropus, kangaroo, Theropus, bat, camelus, camel, macaca, monkey, rattus, rat, canis, dog, felis, cat, elephus, elephant, equus, horse, delphinus is the common dolphin, balaenoptera is the blue whale, one of the largest aquatic mammals, and the panthera tigris is tiger, and panthera leo, it should be small t and this should be small l. Panthera tigris is tiger and panthera leo is lion. So with that we complete the animal kingdom. Now let us do a quick brush up of the next chapter in zoology, which is referred to as structural organization in animals. So you all know that animals are unicellular or multicellular. Of course we don't find unicellular animals. Here they have mentioned that unicellular, in the sense the correct word to call them is they exhibit a cellular level of organization, or they exhibit a tissue level of organization, or an organ level of organization, or an organ system level of organization, like I just mentioned to you. Okay, so animals exhibit cellular level, tissue level, or organ level, or organ system level. Now you know that a tissue is a group of cells which have similar structure, function, and origin, and the science which deals with the branch of biology that deals with the study of tissues is called histology. We are going to learn about some of the major tissues like epithelial, connective, muscular, and neural tissues. Epithelial tissue is nothing but a tissue which consists of a single layered or a multi-layered cells. You know how the cells are present here on top of a basement membrane, isn't it? Now basement membrane is where you have a lot of connective tissue matrix, nerve endings and capillaries, etc. Okay, there is no direct supply of blood to this. That's why we call them as avascular. Epithelial tissue does not receive direct supply of blood, isn't it? And the free cells, which maybe they may be flat, they may be cuboidal, they may have cilia, they may have finger like projections called microvilli, and they are held together with little. You can see how the cells are literally in contact with each other. They have very little intracellular matrix in between them, intercellular matrix in between them. Okay, there are a lot of junctions which can hold the cells together. Like for example, if this is a cell in the epithelial tissue and this is another cell in the epithelial tissue, so you have certain junctions called tight junctions which seal off the space between the two cells so that there is no leakage of such substances. And then you have a cementing substance in between the cells which is called adherent junctions, which ensure that there is no mechanical wear and tear. The cells are mechanically supported to each other. And then there are certain channel like cylindrical proteins which are present, which are referred to as gap junctions, which help in movement of ions and biomolecules between the cells. So what is a simple epithelium? A simple epithelium is an epithelium which has only a single layer of cells on its basement membrane, correct? So it has only a single layer of cells. Now the squamous epithelium is made up of flattened cells. So you have this epithelial layer and then you have these flat cells like this. They are bulged in the center because of the centrally located nucleus. Where do you find these squamous cells? In blood vessels, in air sacs of lungs, even in glomerulus, in the Bowman's capsule of nephron. They function as diffusion boundary. In alveolus, they help in diffusion of gases, isn't it? Then in the inner wall of the blood vessels, do you remember what they are called? They are called endothelium. Yes. Cuboidal epithelium, as the name itself indicates, the cells are cube-like in nature with a centrally located nucleus. Correct. So in squamous epithelium, they were flattened with the bulge center, but in cuboidal epithelium, they are cube-like with a centrally located nucleus. And these are commonly found in the ducts and glands of tubular parts of nephrons, epithelium of proximal convoluted tubule. And these cells in proximal convoluted tubule, if this is a cell, a cuboidal cell, it has fine finger-like projections. And that's why this becomes a brush-bordered cuboidal cell. And this is seen in the case of proximal convoluted tubule. It is meant for secretion and absorption. There are a lot of other parts in the body where you find the cuboidal epithelium. For example, you find it in the thyroid gland, in the testis, in the ovary, in the ciliary muscle of your eye, ciliary body of your eye, in the choroid of the eye, the lining of the iris, in the membranous labyrinth, in the ducts of salivary glands and pancreas, isn't it? So these are the distribution of cuboidal epithelium. Columnar epithelium is mostly found in the stomach and the intestine, and as you know, the cells are very tall and columnar. They are broad at their apices and they are very very narrow at their basis, and they have a basally located nucleus. The function of columnar epithelium is secretion and absorption, and even in columnar epithelium, the columnar cells have finger-like projections which are called microvilli, and then they are referred to as brush-bordered columnar cells, which are mostly found in the small intestine. Okay. Then ciliated epithelium, they have fine hair-like structure at their free ends, which are called cilia. They are found mostly in the bronchial tubes, that is in the trachea, in the nasal passages, and in the fallopian tube, because they help in transportation of substances. In the fallopian tube, they help in transporting the egg. In the case of trachea, they help in transporting mucus that is laden with particulate or dust material, isn't it? Fine. So glandular epithelium means a cell which is secreting something. It secretes substances like mucus, enzymes, hormones, etc. So when a cell is involved in secretion, it is called a glandular epithelium. There are unicellular glands, like for example, there are cells which look like a wine glass. These are called goblet cells. They have a basally located nucleus, and here they secrete an alkaline, a slimy secretion, which is referred to as the mucus. So these are referred to as the goblet cells, the mucus cells or the goblet cells. Then if it's a gland which has many, many cells together, say for example, there are many, many pyramidal cells like this, and all of these cells are secreting something, then we call such a gland as not a unicellular gland. Here it was one cell that was secreting. Here it is many cells that are secreting. So we call them as multicellular glands, like in the case of salivary glands. Then we have multicellular glands are further classified into exocrine glands and endocrine glands. Exocrine glands are those which have a duct. They don't pour their secretion directly into the bloodstream, whereas endocrine glands are those which pour their secretion directly into the bloodstream. They do not have ducts. Then coming to compound epithelium, where there are multiple layers. Now why should an epithelium have, say for example, it has a basal layer like this? Basically, the names are given based on the superficial layer. So as you go up, you can see how the cells are becoming flat and flat and flat. So this is what is referred to as compound epithelium. See, there are so many layers of cells here. That's why it is referred to as a compound epithelium or a stratified epithelium. It's mostly to protect from mechanical and chemical stressors, and it is used in absorption of water and products of digestion. It may be used in kidney. There are in kidney, in the ducts also you have compound epithelium. Okay. So basically you have, this one gives you the functions of what is called as the different types of epithelium. So it is usually found in the underlying tissues of the skin. It helps in protecting you from damage. It helps in absorption of water, like in the ducts of kidney, like proximal convoluted tubule, distal convoluted tubule, etc. Now they have only given one example here of this compound epithelium. This can be called as stratified, because the uppermost layer of cells are flat, isn't it? So we call them as the stratified squamous epithelium. Now this stratified squamous epithelium is of two types. There is moist stratified squamous and there is dry, a very loose term to use, but you must be aware, moist means it is non-keratinized, the cells are not impregnated with a protein called keratin, and dry means they are made very very durable because they are impregnated with a protein called keratin. Now the dry is where you find on your skin. The skin is very durable and it is waterproof because of this. Compare the surface of your skin with the surface of the inside of your mouth. That's where you have moist. The cells of the superficial layer are not heavily deposited with keratin, so we call them as non-keratinized or non-cornified. Keratinized or cornified, both of them are stratified squamous cells. Connective tissue, they are basically helping in linking and supporting other tissues in the system. Like for example, they connect bone to bone, they connect muscle to bone, etc. And these cells of connective tissue basically have, generally you have in a connective tissue, in any connective tissue that you take, there will be a background substance. This is called the ground substance. It is jelly-like, and in this substance, you will find fibers occurring in tufts or occurring in singles, and then you will find these special cells which are involved in secreting these fibers. Now these cells which secrete these fibers are called fibroblasts. You will see additional cells which we will discuss later. So basically there is a matrix which is called the ground substance, and then you have the fibers, two types of fibers, collagen fibers and elastin fibers, and then you have cells in any connective tissue that you consider. Loose connective tissue means, why is it called loose connective tissue? That means there are less fibers or it is less dense. There's a lot of flexibility and lot of pliability, and it is very very flexible and elastic, and that's why it is called loose connective tissue. Areolar connective tissue is the most common form of connective tissue present beneath the skin. It has cells called fibroblasts, macrophages, mast cells. Macrophages are phagocytic in nature. Mast cells secrete histamine and heparin in response to allergic reaction. And then it has fibers, like I mentioned previously, collagen fibers and elastin fibers. So you can see how this network of areolar connective tissue looks like, isn't it? So you can see these bundles, these are referred to as the these pink colored bundles are nothing but the collagen fibers, and these single fibers that you see are elastin fibers. Collagen fibers offer tensile strength and rigidity to the tissue, whereas elastin fibers offer a lot of flexibility to the tissue. In between you can find these allergy sensitive cells which are called mast cells, and you have cells which secrete these fibers called fibroblasts, and then you have collagen fibers. It's named as reticular fibers, but actually they are the collagen fibers. Okay, then you have fat underneath the skin and around internal organs, and that is basically the adipose tissue, which helps in packaging your internal organs and also protects your internal organs from mechanical damage. It provides a cushioning effect. Then we have loose connective tissue. After that we have to learn about dense connective tissue. That means there are a lot of fibers in dense connective tissue. If all the fibers are arranged in a regular pattern, then we call it as dense regular. If all the fibers are arranged in a haphazard pattern, then we refer to it as dense irregular. Dense regular example is tendon and ligament. Tendon connects muscle to bone, ligament connects bone to bone. And dense irregular connective tissue, where you have irregularly or haphazardly arranged collagen fibers, you find them around the protective coverings of your kidney, your adrenal gland, your liver, that is the Glisson's capsule, in your skin, in your submucosa of your intestine, in the outer surface of your cartilage and bone, etc. So then moving on to specialized connective tissue. When we talk about special connective tissue, we talk about bone, cartilage and blood. Okay, so that comes under skeletal tissue. Now cartilage is something that is present. You know the difference between the cartilage, for example, in your external ear, and the bones. Bones are very, very sturdy. You cannot bend them. They're not pliable. But cartilage is pliable. It's found in the tip of your nose, in the ear pinna, between the adjacent long bones of your vertebral column. It's found in the rings of the trachea, in the larynx, etc. Bones are very hard and pliable. They are present only in vertebrates. Okay. And in the bone, you have these special cells which are called as osteocytes. The cells are present in spaces which are referred to as lacunae. So here you can see how a mammalian bone, you can see how it is arranged. The bone is deposited in the form of these circular units called Haversian canals. Each Haversian system, in the center of the Haversian system, you have the Haversian canal. And if you were to look here, this is a Haversian system. If you were to look into the Haversian system, you will see that there are spaces in them which are called lacunae. If this is the lacunae, then you find this bone cell sitting inside the lacunae, and the lacunae gives out tube-like projections which are called canaliculi, and into the canaliculi extend the filopodia, which are membranous projections of the osteocyte, because they want to communicate with the osteocytes of the neighboring lacunae. So how are these bone cells present? They are present in the form of, you can see here, in the form of concentric layers. This is how compact bone is organized in the case of mammals. So now moving on to muscle tissue. Muscle tissue, the most important function of muscle tissue is it has contractibility, it has response to stimuli, isn't it? and it also can relax in a coordinated fashion. It plays a very important role in movements of the body parts, and muscle tissue can be classified into skeletal muscle, into smooth muscle, as well as into cardiac muscle. Now, skeletal muscle, as you all know, the muscles are arranged in parallel bundles called muscle fascicles, and these skeletal muscles are voluntary in function. And you must be aware that if you take a skeletal muscle fiber, fiber is nothing but a muscle cell. It is cylindrical in nature, and then it has multiple nuclei which are located peripherally, and it is called striated muscle because all throughout the cytoplasm of the skeletal muscle, you can see these dark, light striations. So these are the dark, in between you have light, dark, light, dark, light, dark, light striations. So cylindrical with multinucleate structures are seen in skeletal muscles. Smooth muscles are very different. They have a spindle-like structure, they have tapering ends, they have a centrally located nucleus. They do have actin and myosin, but the actin and myosin is not organized in a regular pattern to produce striations, and that's why they are called unstriated muscle. Most of these skeletal muscles which we discussed, they are attached to the bone, that's why they are called skeletal muscles, whereas smooth muscles are found in the visceral organs like your digestive system, the uterus, the oviduct, the iris, the diaphragm, below your lungs, etc. Cardiac muscle fibers are also cylindrical, but they are branched. They also have a striated pattern, but they are not multinucleated, they are uninucleated. And one cardiac muscle cell communicates with another cardiac muscle fiber with the help of these intercalary. Say for example, this is a cardiac muscle cell. So this is a branched pattern like this. So this is one cardiac muscle cell, this is the second cardiac muscle cell. Okay, now this has one nucleus, this has the second nucleus. In between the two, you can see these disc-like structures. Now these disc-like structures are called the intercalary discs. Okay, and these are the ones which help in communication between this muscle cell and this muscle cell. Why should one cardiac muscle fiber communicate with the next cardiac muscle fiber? Suppose this cardiac muscle fiber receives a signal or a stimulus, it starts undergoing contraction, it gets excited. This excitation must immediately be passed on to the next cardiac muscle also, otherwise your heart muscles will not contract and relax in a rhythmic manner. If one of them gets excited, all the others need to receive that excitation, and that happens because of these intercalated discs, which is referred to as the communication junction. Neural tissue, you all are aware, you have nerves and neuroglia. The supporting cells are referred to as the neuroglia, whereas the structural and functional units of neural system are referred to as the neuron or the nerve cells. Okay, these are the actual excitable cells. They have a cell body, they have the antennae called dendrites which pick up the stimuli, and they have the conducting system which conducts the signal to the next neuron, which is called axon. Okay. And basically, there is transmission of nerve impulses. When a neuron undergoes an electrical disturbance, it is said to generate an electric voltage. It is said to generate a voltage of plus 30 millivolt. And this voltage that is generated along the axon of a neuron when it is excited, it is referred to as the nerve impulse. The technical term for the nerve impulse is the action potential. Okay. So you can see how these are the antennae which pick up the signal. These smaller branches are called the dendrites, and this is the cell body where you have the nucleus, and there are certain granules which are present in the nucleus. You all know them as the Nissl's body, isn't it? The Nissl body which are rich in ribosomes, and they're actively involved in protein synthesis. And then you have a cone-like portion which is called the axon hillock, and then you have this unbranched cylindrical portion which is called the axon. And you all are aware how the axon branches into finer branches, and it sends signals to the next. It ends in these bulb-like structure which are referred to as the synaptic bulbs or the synaptic button. And then you have another neuron over here, and this neuron has dendrites in contact with these synaptic buttons, and these are the ones which pick up the signal, and the same cycle is repeated again. It passes through If this neuron has an axon of its own, again it reaches the axon terminal of that neuron. And this physiological junction between one neuron and the other is referred to as the synapse. Correct? Now coming to cockroach, let us just do a very quick review of what we had discussed in cockroach, what you all can remember. It belongs to phylum Arthropoda. The two common species in India are Periplaneta americana and Blatta orientalis. Okay, they live in warm, dark and damp places. They are nocturnal. Morphology of cockroach, you all are aware. So basically it has a head with a pair of compound eye, and then it has a triangular shield-like structure, isn't it? And then on one side it has a larger wing, you cannot see what's inside, and then there is a second thoracic segment, there's a third thoracic segment, and then there is abdomen with 10 segments totally. And so this segment, this large triangular shield which is covering the body, the neck of the cockroach, is referred to as, so this is the head, and then the head has a pair of antennae and a pair of compound eyes. And this structure, which is referred to as the pronotum, it is a shield which covers the neck region, and it is made up of chitin, isn't it? And then it is covering the first thoracic segment. So inside you have the first thoracic segment, this is the second thoracic segment, this is the third thoracic segment. The second thoracic segment is attached to a wing which is called the forewing, and the third thoracic segment is attached to another wing which is called the hind wing. So the second thoracic segment is called the mesothorax, the third thoracic segment is called the metathorax. This wing, which is the forewing, is not functional, as in it doesn't help in flight. It only protects the hind wing. It is called the tegmina, and this is the actual part of the wing, the hind wing, which is attached to the third thoracic segment, which is membranous, which helps in flight. Correct? And then you can see there are 10 abdominal segments in the cockroach, and specifically the last, the 10th abdominal segment is forked like this, and attached to the 10th abdominal segment is a multiple, a jointed filament, which is referred to as, which is common to both male and female, which is referred to as the anal sulcus. Okay? Another thing about the body of cockroach is, the body of cockroach is consisting, it's covered on the outside by numerous chitinous exoskeletal plates, and these chitinous exoskeletal plates are called the sclerites. Okay, on the back. Now for example, if this is the cockroach, you're looking at the cockroach from the side, this is the mouth, head, and see the neck is also here. See, did you notice that the head is at right angles to the longitudinal axis of the body, isn't it? Now on the body of cockroach, the exoskeleton, this is the skin of the cockroach, if you imagine, outside the skin of the cockroach you will find these plates, exoskeletal plates. So you will find these plates which are arranged on the outside. That means these, the cuticle or these exoskeletal plates, is not a continuous layer. It is made up of individual plates which are fitted into one another. The dorsal plate on the upper surface of the cockroach is called a tergite. The ventral plate on the lower surface is called a sternite. And how are they united to each other? They are connected together by a delicate membrane. Why should they be connected? So that to offer some amount of flexibility. This delicate membrane that covers, that connects the tergites, adjacent tergites, is referred to as the arthrodial membrane. So this is the organization of exoskeleton of cockroach. The chitinous layer, the chitinous exoskeleton, is not a continuous layer, but it is made up of individual plates. The dorsal plates are called tergites, and the ventral plates are referred to as sternites. And like we saw in the head, it is formed by the fusion of 6 embryonic segments, and then the head has a pair of compound eye, a pair of fenestra, which may be reduced form of simple eye, which is sensitive to light. Then there are a pair of filament antennae which help in monitoring the surrounding environment. So you have, this is the compound eye of the head, and in front of the compound eye you have the antenna. The antenna is a filamentous structure which helps in monitoring the surrounding environment. And what is the uniqueness of the eye of the cockroach? The unique feature of if this is the head again, and if this is the eye of the cockroach, the eye of the cockroach is composed of the spine hexagonal units, and these hexagonal units are referred to as ommatidia or ocelli. Each cockroach eye has 2000 such hexagonal units, which is referred to as ommatidia. That's why we call the eye of cockroach as a compound eye, whereas these hexagonal units are referred to as the simple eye or ommatidia. Okay. Now coming to the mouth parts. Now again, for the mouth part, you have to look at the cockroach, the head of the cockroach. This is the neck, and this is the body. You're looking at it from the side. So this is the eye. The cockroach is seeing in the front here, isn't it? So you have a mouth part, the upper lip, which is called the labrum. Behind the labrum, there is mandible, and behind that you have the maxilla, and then you have the labium. How do you know which is the maxilla and which is the labium? Maxilla will have a 5-segmented maxillary palp, and labium will have a 3-segmented labial palp. So this is the upper lip or the labrum. Now labrum is only one, whereas the mandible, which I spoke of, is two. You're looking at the side. So one on this side, one on the other side. The maxillae is also two in number, one on this side, one on the other side. Whereas the labium or the lower lip is only one in number. Okay. Now in the abdomen, the difference between the male and the female abdomen is, if you're looking at the abdomen of a cockroach, say for example, this is the abdomen, you're looking at it from the side. In case of female, what happens is, so let me try and simplify it for you. I told you that there are plates on the upper surface of the abdomen. So this is the plate number 9, and this is the plate number 10. On the upper surface segment, this is a plate, the tergite of the 9th segment, this is the tergite of the 10th segment. I told you that the tergite of the 10th segment has a multi-jointed structure, which is referred to as the anal sulcus. Now in case of female, what happens is, there is a huge boat shaped plate which is present on the ventral side. This boat shaped plate is the 7th sternum. Then you may ask me a question. On top, we were discussing about the 8th tergite and the 9th tergite. Then what about the 8th and the 9th sternite here? The 8th and the 9th sternite are hidden inside the 7th sternite, and they form a chamber, and this chamber is referred to as the genital chamber, into which there is the opening of the female reproductive system. So remember, in case of female cockroaches, remember, you're looking at it from the side, you're looking at the tip of the abdomen. This is the back of the cockroach or the dorsal side. This is the lower belly side or the ventral side. So you have these chitinous plates which are present on the dorsal side. 8 and 9 are normally found. But in female cockroaches, the plate that you see corresponding to the 8th and the 9th above is not the 8th and the 9th sternum. It is a boat-shaped sternum that is referred to as the 7th sternum. The 8th and the 9th sternum are within the 7th sternum, enclosing a space which is referred to as the genital space. But what about in male? In male, if you look at the tip of the abdomen, you will find the 8th tergum, the 9th, the 8th tergum. I'm so sorry, this was the 9th tergum and this was the 10th tergum. The 10th sternum is missing. You can only see this is the 7th sternum, and hidden inside you have the 8th sternum and you have the 9th sternum. 10th sternum is absent in both male and female cockroaches. So again, I'm showing you here, this is the 9th tergum, this is the 10th tergum, and it is always the 10th tergum of the cockroach which basically has the anal sulci attached to it. And on the lower surface, in males you have the 8th sternum and you have the 9th sternum. I already told you that you have only sternum up to the 8th and the 9th segment. The 10th segment, the 10th sternum is missing. Attached to the 9th sternum is a pair of needle-like structures which are found only in the male cockroaches, which are referred to as the anal style. Okay. Now, and ventrally. So here you will somewhere find the opening of the male reproductive system, and on the dorsal side you will find the opening of the anus. So remember, we are looking at the abdominal end, and this needle like a small filament that is emerging from the ninth wart. This is the ventral side, this is the dorsal side. So these are the tergites, these are the sternites. This is referred to as the anal style. All right. Then you know the parts of the digestive system. There is mouth, there is pharynx, there is esophagus, there is crop and gizzard. Now gizzard is something very important, because here is where the churning and the grinding of food happens, correct? And in between, in the front of the esophagus, there is a narrow tube that is referred to as the pharynx. The pharynx leads into esophagus, and then we saw that there is a huge chamber. So if this is the pharynx, esophagus opens into, so this portion is the pharynx and then esophagus, and then you know that there is a pouch called the crop, and then there is a gizzard, and at the junction of the gizzard and the midgut you have these 6 to 8 blind ending tube like structures which are called as hepatic cheek, isn't it? And then you have a very small portion called mesenteron and midgut, and then you have 100 to 150 what thread like yellow colored Malpighian tubules, and then you have the ileum, the colon, and lastly you have the rectum which opens out through the anus. So I hope you remember the parts of the digestive system of the cockroach. Circulatory system, if you remember, if this is the body of the cockroach, we had learned that the circulatory system consists of these funnel-like structures, and these funnel-like structures, how many such funnel-like structures are present? These funnel-like structures are the chambers of the heart. A total of 13 funnel-like structures are joined end-to-end. So basically we say that the cockroach has a 13-chambered heart. On both sides of the heart, you can see these triangular wing-like muscles which are called the alary muscles, isn't it? Now each funnel has a narrow neck and a broader base. The broader base of the funnel is fitted into the narrow neck of the next funnel, and in between there are openings for the blood to enter the heart. These openings are called the ostia. Through the ostia, the blood enters from the surrounding space. Notice there are no blood vessels. Blood is freely flowing in the space around the heart. What is this space? The coelom in which the blood is freely flowing. It is referred to as the hemocoel. So it flows freely in the hemocoelic channels. Now this is the pathway of the passage of the blood in cockroach. So in cockroach, again I'm showing you the sideward view. So you have, this is the head, you have two membranes which divide the body into three compartments. This is a membrane with openings in between, which is called the ventral diaphragm, and there is a membrane on top with openings in between called the dorsal diaphragm. Okay, now this space is called the perineural sinus, this is called the perivisceral sinus, this is called the pericardial sinus. Heart is over here, so let me show a small tube over here. So blood comes out of the heart, it passes through all the chambers, it enters the space in the head, and then it passes into the lower chamber first, which is called the perineural sinus, and then it passes through these openings into the perivisceral sinus, and then it passes into the pericardial sinus, and through the ostia it enters back into the heart. So this is the pathway of circulation in cockroach. Respiratory system includes trachea. They have 10 pairs of trachea, 2 in the thoracic region and remaining 8 in the abdominal region. The trachea branch out into fine tubes which enter individual cells, which deliver oxygen to individual cells. These fine tubes delivering oxygen are called the tracheoles. So during inspiration, mechanism of respiration, it's very important that the tracheoles, which are the fine tubes which make their way into the cells, they are the ones which are provided with lot of fluid in them. The fluid will help in transporting the oxygen into the cells. Similarly, the fluid also takes up carbon dioxide from the cells, and the carbon dioxide is let out of the spiracle. Okay. Excretory system, we had learned 100 to 150 yellow colored thread like structures which are called Malpighian tubules. And then there are the Malpighian tubules are provided with glandular and ciliated cells. Please remember, cockroach eliminates uric acid as its nitrogenous waste. It is referred to as uricotelic. The nervous system in case of cockroach is present around the esophagus. That's why we call it a circumesophageal ganglia. A pair of ganglia called cerebral ganglia, which is similar to the brain, a poorly developed brain, is present above the esophagus. That's why it is called supraesophageal ganglia. Okay, so now imagine this is the nervous system. It is a hollow tube like this. So it is through this these two swollen structures above, which I'm shading here. These are the and this is the canal through which the esophagus passes. Okay. And then you have the crop and the gizzard and all that, isn't it? So esophagus is surrounded by the brain. These two structures are called supraesophageal because they are present above the esophagus. And this is called subesophageal ganglia. It's two fused into one. And because it is present below the esophagus, it is called subesophageal ganglia. And then you have, at regular intervals, you have paired nerve cords. And then you have ganglia present in each segment of the body. There are totally three ganglia that are located in the thorax. One of them is present in the prothorax, the first thoracic segment, one in the second thoracic segment, one in the third thoracic segment. And totally, the double ventral nerve cord has a total of six ganglia in the abdomen. So six ganglia in the abdomen plus 3, 7, 8, 9. Totally, there are 9 ganglia in the body of the cockroach. Okay, 3 in the thoracic region and 6 in the abdominal region. And like we saw, how are the ganglia united together? They're united together by these paired double ventral nerve cord. And where does the nerve cord originate from? From a ganglia called subesophageal ganglia present below the esophagus. And you can see how a ring is connecting the upper ganglia with the lower ganglia. And this ring is called the circum because it goes around the esophagus, isn't it? That's why it is called the circumesophageal connective. And these two swollen structures which I have shaded over here, these are the ones which are the actual parts of the brain, which are called the supraesophageal ganglia. Then moving on to the reproductive system, the male reproductive system and the female reproductive system. Now the male reproductive system has, if you remember the male reproductive system, there are three lobe testes present between the segments 4, 5 and 6 of the abdomen, and from each of them a vas deferens comes, it loops behind, and then it joins a mushroom shaped gland which have longer tubules. Yes. Mushroom shaped gland is present somewhere between the 6th to the 7th abdominal segment, and then there are smaller tubules here, and then it joins, the vas deferens joins, and it continues down as a broad muscular tube called ejaculatory duct, which opens out to the male genital aperture. Then behind the mushroom shaped gland, there is another gland whose duct you can see passing here and opening very close to the male genital. And this gland that is present behind the mushroom shaped gland is referred to as the phallic or the conglobate gland. Okay, so very, very simple. I have cut short the explanation. So you have to open the textbook, go through the diagram, and you will be able to recall that there are these longer tubes which are called utriculi majoris, there are shorter tubes called utriculi brevioris, and then there is two openings, the opening of the ejaculatory duct and the opening of the phallic duct. And then I showed you that the vas deferens from the testis comes up like this, it loops behind like this, it goes behind. And then I told you that there is a mushroom shaped gland. The mushroom shaped gland, it looks almost like a sunflower here in this diagram. It has longer tubes. The longer tubes are what I'm showing you right now, correct? And it has shorter tubes over here. And then it continues as the vas deferens actually opens into this muscular tube called the ejaculatory duct. And this mushroom shaped gland is present at the junction of the vas deferens and the ejaculatory duct. And then you have to see behind these smaller tubes, you can also find another on the ventral side of the ejaculatory duct. You can find certain tubes which are referred to as the seminal vesicle. It is in the seminal vesicle that the sperms are bundled up together to form clusters called spermatophores. Okay. Female reproductive system, it consists of a pair of ovaries, isn't it? And which open into so basically the ovary is made up of these individual tubules. What are these individual tubules? These are referred to as ovarian tubules or ovarioles. There are 8 per ovary. So I have shown you here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and behind you can see 6, 7, 8. So these tubes are referred to as the ovarioles. The eggs are released by the ovarioles and the eggs come down through this oviduct. So this is the oviduct. And the two oviducts unite together to form a common oviduct, which is called the vagina, which opens out through the female genital aperture. And the ovary extends between the second to the sixth abdominal segment. Okay, second to the sixth abdominal segment is where, like we saw in the testis, it was the fourth to the sixth abdominal segments. In case of the female reproductive system of cockroach, it is the second to the sixth abdominal segment. And once the female undergoes fertilization, once the male sperm are transferred into the female reproductive system, the female produces the egg cases, about 9 to 10 of them. Each egg case contains about 14 to 15 eggs in them. The development is porometabolous. Porometabolous means the young one is a miniature form of the adult, okay? And the young one, which resembles the adult except that it doesn't have the wings and it is sexually immature, is referred to as the nymph. It undergoes 13 times molting in order to become the adult, okay? So this was the a quick summary of two major chapters, Animal Kingdom and Structural Organizations. So until next time, all of you take care and happy studying for your NEET examination.